Drive this morning on a lovely cloudy and possibly rainy morning, but we're not sure just yet. Now, you'll hear me chatting away to Kirsty because we are going to do some checks on the vehicle and all those types of things as we do in the pre-show. Kirsty, I think Brian's ready for his checks, and then I suppose we can chat about that other thing that you were trying to tell me. Oh, those are bright lights.
Yeah, I copy you now. Copy you good.
I should have put that on open mic so the viewers could have heard. Exactly how fast, because you can say all of those checks. She could actually go to the Olympics, she's so good. Morning, buffalo. Don't go into camp because you guys are rude. Some naughty buffalo. I am so complimentary, hey Kirsty. Right, so Kirsty, do you say that again? So when you count me down from 7 seconds, so does it affect me or the viewer, the next guide you're presenting? Oh, that doesn't make sense. Yeah. Oh, okay. Fantastic. Okay, that's fine. Oh, that makes a lot more sense. Okay. Thank you. We were chatting about these little overlay things that come in that make us sound all fancy. Now, of course, it's actually quite windy here, which is pleasant after yesterday's heat, and none of us slept really because it was so hot. We were baking like we were in a sauna for the entire night. Now, I'm looking for the lions this morning. You can see Brian's there just cleaning the lens nicely so you can all see well. But it's a bit dark still to do some decent tracking, so that's why I've got all 7,000 lights on to see if I can see any footprints. And I believe there were some lions at the dam cam, but we won't be able to go there just yet because I don't think the other guides are out right now. That's okay, but we'll go the scenic way around and check sort of the last area that they were, while I also try and check for some footprints, and hopefully we shall find them. Can hear the GoPros turning on. How are you doing, Brian? Are you getting all sorted?
Yeah, I'm nearly ready.
Nearly ready.
I need to clean that GoPro though.
Oh, okay, we'll clean it. Let me just not blind all the Impala. Sorry, Impala. I'll turn my bright lights off. Should we stop over here? Is this a good spot to clean the GoPro?
Yeah, any spot is good.
We should stop here in and amongst the Impala. While Brian, of course, is going to very quickly. He's going to clean the GoPro very quickly. There you go, you can watch him. 22 and 71. Oh, it's not as cold as I thought it was going to be today. The Impala obviously don't like Brian very much because they're running away from him now.
Yeah.
Did you not shower today?
I didn't.
That's what happens. It smells, must smell like a musky elephant.
Sweeter than an elephant's musk.
Huh? It's good though because we're saving water.
It is.
We actually are saving water, yes. Well, it's good because I need to wash my hair today, so I will use Brian's quota of water this morning.
I like to give my quotients and quotas of water to other people.
Oh, thank you. That's very kind. I don't know if you heard that. Brian said he likes to give his portions of water to other people. I think that's very nice of him. It just shows how genuine of a person he really is. Such a good, upstanding citizen.
I do what I can.
Hey, right. Now, we're coming to our final seconds of our pre-drive. So I'm going to have to say, unfortunately, goodbye to you, but not for long, of course. It'll just be a moment before you see my big blonde ponytail bouncing.
This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
It's a cool, windy, cloudy morning. We've got some waterbuck just off to our right, and this is Safari Live, everyone.
Ready?
Standing by.
Good morning, everybody, and welcome to Safari Live on our Sunrise Safari. And you can see those are the waterbuck I just mentioned that are off to our right. And if you have a look at that cloudy weather, very, very cloudy this morning. It's still a little dark, so I have got the spotlight out. I've been driving around for the last 10, 15 minutes with the spotlight, trying to see if we can find anything. It's a cool morning. So it's about 22 degrees Celsius, 71 degrees Fahrenheit. My name is Byron. On camera is Dave this morning. And on the other vehicle is Taylor and Brian, of course. And then in the FC, Kirsten and Lou. It's great to have all of you with us again this morning. I'm on my way to Cheetah Plains. That is our plan. And we're going to see what we can find over there. So far, it's been fairly quiet. We've been driving around. We've seen lots of impala around. And I think what's happened is, because of this breeze which has been blowing at the moment, a lot of the impala and some of the other antelope species have all moved up into the clearings. And the reason for that is, because of the wind, they want to stay close together. They cannot rely on their sense of smell or their hearing to look out for predators, because with this wind it does make it a lot harder to smell or hear them. So they head out onto the clearings for safety and to warn each other if they do see any predators. It's a lot more open and it will be easier for them to spot them. So as I said, we're driving along and just trying to see what we can find. Nice to see some waterbuck first up in the morning. We saw something large running off through this area as we approached it. I think it was a hippo that may have just wandered through here, possibly still out feeding for the morning, and we'll probably try and find a waterhole very, very soon. Don't forget, everybody, we are completely live. Send us your questions at hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. Otherwise, email us questions at wildearth.tv. And we'll gladly answer your questions, and we love hearing from all our viewers. Charlie, you said you hope that we see a hyena this morning. That would be wonderful. Haven't seen a hyena for quite some time. And you never know, it is a possibility. It's funny, Charlie, we've actually seen quite a few hyena tracks in that around on most of the roads in the last 2 or 3 weeks, but just haven't seen them. So not too sure where they're hiding at the moment, but they are around. There's just some more waterbuck off to our left. And have a look, just some females with that white ring around the rump and that very shaggy coat of theirs, very easy to identify. And beautiful waterbuck. Okay, so we're going to continue straight down towards Cheetah Plains and have a good look around those clearings for any animals. While I do that, let's head back to Taylor and so she can say good morning and let you know what her plans are for the day.
Good morning. There you go, I'm done now. That's all I had to say, wasn't it? No, of course, I'm just choking. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to a wonderful day. It's nice and cool. I've even got a jersey on, and so does Brian. Now, of course, my name is Taylor, and like I just said, Brian's on camera with an ever so handsome thumb this morning, who's looking very smart. You know, Brian, I always feel a little bit embarrassed when I drive with you, because especially in the mornings, because I feel like the thumb is always so overdressed for a morning safari. I think I'm going to have to wear a tie one morning, and perhaps a suit. I don't know. I don't own a suit though, but I shall borrow one. Pantsuit, yeah. We'll do smart khaki wear. I don't know what that is, but we shall try it out. And we've got a couple of impala darting across the road, as you can see. Don't be scared of me, I'm not a lion. There they go. But I think it's because I've got some of my lights on. And the reason why I've got my lights on is because I had some lion tracks and they were going up and down here. So I was just trying to establish, of course, which way they were going. So like I said in the pre-drive drive, there were a couple of lions that visited the pan in the wee early hours of this morning. So I'm just checking. I'm going to sneak up towards the lodge and just have a little look around. And then what I shall do is we'll probably go back along all the way down Twin Dams and head to where they were last seen. But we'll just take a little slow drive here. See, the problem is, I love getting up early, don't get me wrong. It's fantastic because it's when all the action happens. Well, not all the time. But it makes it very difficult to track. You'll see you have to use a spotlight. And even then, tracking with a spotlight is very, very difficult. So we'll just take it very easy and not go too fast because I don't want to miss any more tracks. Yes, so it doesn't look like there's any lions around and I can't really go too much further. So we will go the scenic way around. We'll go back along Twin Dams and then we'll try and get to, of course, the other side. Thank you, Chris. Chris says that the lions went sort of towards the quarantine area or towards the drainage. So we're going to have a look here. I did see tracks. It's going to be very difficult to show you now this morning, I'm afraid. But there's lots of impala around and they seem to be quite relaxed and just really scared of me today. And as we were coming along this way, there were lion tracks coming both towards the pan and then going away. But the fresher tracks look like they were actually going away, going sort of back east, southeast-ish. So we'll go down there and we'll have a look. So I came down Wahlbergs Road and that's where I saw all the tracks. So let's continue further east and then we'll do a big loop. I wouldn't surprise me if they were in the drainage line. It's like their permanent home. They love it. I was actually saying this morning, they are always in this drainage line, whether they're south of the drainage or north of the drainage. This is where they live. And it's not a bad spot. They've obviously seemed to have worked it out. I don't know how well this technique is going to work in the summer months though, because the animals are not going to be drawn to the drainage lines as much. Well, because there's going to be lots of leaves on the trees, so lots of shade all around. And then of course, the more rain we get, well, they're going to move further and further away because the open plains all have nice long grass on them. But we shall see. So we'll just take it easy around here. Fantastic. So now we're going to carry on searching and hopefully the next time you come back to me, I'm going to have some lions for you. But let's go back across to Byron, who has got some impala.
We have got a lovely herd of impala around here, everyone. But as we drove up, we saw something small running across the road. Now, I don't want to get anyone excited just yet. Not sure if it was lambs or if there were two or three little steenbok running around, but can't seem to see them now. I'm just going to have a look on the other side of the road again. Just hang on, let's have a good look around here. I don't know, they seem very small. Dave and I were both a bit confused as to what they are. Wouldn't that be exciting if there were some lambs, but I don't see anything now. Let's just have a quick scan around here. Some more over there. I'm going to use my binoculars. No, I don't see anything. Just the adults. So I think we got a little excited there for nothing. I think it was perhaps two little Daker or Steenbok. We saw them, and again, as we said, the light isn't great at the moment. We saw them from quite a distance driving down into Seri. We just saw these little things dart across the road, and it may have been a pair of Daker or Steenbok that just ran past the impala. So I don't see any sign of anything else that size around here at the moment. But it would have been very exciting if there were some lambs. I think we've got two more days until my prediction. I said the 9th of November. Dave, what did you say? Also around there, so could be interesting. Who knows, very soon. And those of you
who are watching and wondering why we say that is because the impala have a strict breeding season. So they all give birth around the beginning of November, beginning to middle of November. And that is why we've been taking bets on when we're going to see the first impala. Look at that nice group of males with females. This is a nice herd. Quite a large herd. Very, very playful this morning. This cool summer's morning makes for a change. Because it has been very, very hot, and yesterday was incredibly hot. Yesterday was about 98 degrees Fahrenheit. And now we're down to a cool 71 degrees. And I wonder if this, but I do think that perhaps this cloud cover will burn off a little bit later. And it may become quite warm again. I'm not sure. Kirsten did tell us earlier, she checked the weather and there was a chance of rain. Was it a 20% chance? Yeah, so not a huge chance, but a chance nonetheless. And we do need the rain, everyone. It is still a little bit dry, even though the bush has started to transform, because we have been fortunate. We have had a bit of rain here on Juma, which is where we are this morning, in the greater Kruger National Park, right up in the northeastern part of South Africa. And we have had some rain here. So this area is looking fairly green already, and you can see all these antelope are enjoying the green grass and a lot of the green trees around. Where's it's funny, but just south of us, not too far, maybe 15, 20 kilometers south. So what's that, about 12 miles or so, 12, 14 miles south of us. And it's still very, very dry there. Those areas have not had any rain. And it's very, very barren, very dry. So still going through a drought. So we do need a lot more rain. Hopefully we'll start getting some fairly soon. Donald, you are correct. It is meant to be hot here, but occasionally we have these mornings where the temperature drops a little bit. And as I said, I think later it could possibly burn off this cloud cover and it may become very hot again, just like yesterday. Yesterday, as I was saying, it was about 36 degrees Celsius or 98 degrees Fahrenheit. It was very hot yesterday. We cooked all evening, actually, and only I think it was about 2 or 3 this morning the temperature really started to drop. This cool breeze came in and a bit of cloud cover, and it does happen now and then. Look how playful these impala are. They're wonderful to watch. It really is lovely to see them. So Kathy, you wanted to know, do the markings on the rump of these impalas, do they confuse predators? Kathy, I don't think those markings are there to confuse the predators. There are a few reasons. A few reasons, or theories rather, why those impala have markings on the rump. So probably the main one is that those darker markings attract the ticks to those areas around the rump. And if you have a look, that female, her head was turned there now, but they are able to then turn around. Oh, look at that. Wow, that's amazing. You see them jumping. Very playful this morning. And so they are able to then turn around and groom themselves or clean themselves and get the ticks or bite the ticks off of them. And then it's easier to reach. They can reach those markings. So the theory is that their darker skin coloration or darker hair attracts the ticks, and then they are able to turn around and basically clean themselves and get the ticks off of them. That is the one theory. And then also the other theory is just it helps with a following mechanism, a way to follow each other away from predators. Also, the impala also have white tufts under the tail, and you'll see every time they flick their tail, you'll see the little white tufts. But if they are startled, they lift their tail up, and you see, there we go, and you'll see the white very clearly, and that allows them to follow one another too. So, few reasons, but don't believe that it is there to confuse the predators in any way. And those of you who were with us yesterday, we had a wonderful afternoon. Got to see lions and leopard. And Kathy from Tennessee, you wanted to know, I missed the beginning of the question, something about the impala. You wanted to know if the impala give birth out in the open. Kathy, I'm not, to be honest, I think often what happens is they'd prefer to give birth just in the thickets, where they're a little bit more or better hidden. Look at those young impala, young males just playing. That was not proper fighting. They were just playing. So Kathy, they do probably prefer moving into the thickets where they can give birth a bit better hidden, away from or out of sight of perhaps predators watching. However, I think they will also give birth out on the clearings at times. It depends on the time of day when they are giving birth. At night, most definitely, if they are giving birth, they'll give birth out on the clearings, because then it's easier to look out for predators. During the day, it's probably a bit better for them just to do it in between some trees and in a thicket. So I think both. Yeah. All right. We are going to continue towards Cheetah Plains, everyone. And I think the next time I speak to you will probably be on Cheetah Plains. While I do that, Taylor's got some elephant to show you.
We've got many elephants, and they're eating the roots from this variable bush willow tree, as you can see. She's crunching away. I'm hoping that she was going to crunch for you so you could hear it. No, she's doing everything now but eating the root. But when they eat the roots, it almost sounds like they're biting into a juicy ice lolly, sort of a crunch, but it also, you can hear the moisture that's in these lovely roots. And that's why, one of the reasons why they eat them. Let's see if she now... She's not doing a very good job of putting that one in her mouth, is she? She keeps trying to put it in vertically. I think you need to turn it around, my dear. Here we go, but she's trying to wedge up another root. No, she doesn't want that pathetic little stick. She's going for the gold. There you go. Look how easily she's able to pull it. Using, of course, her foot when her trunk is not strong enough to pull it right out of the ground and snap it. Isn't that amazing? Look at those toes as well. So they've got the four toes on the front and only three toes on the back, unlike the Asian elephant, if I'm not mistaken. They've got five toes on the front and four on the back. So that's another one of the differences between the African and Asian elephants. Come on, girl, pull that out. I want to see that root snap. There you go, she's wedging it under her heel. No. She's still struggling with that first root that we've been seeing. There we go, that's better. Put it right into the back. So now you can hear what I mean when I try and describe it as squashing or chewing on a, not quite a frozen ice lolly, but something sort of in between that. It sort of sounds slushy as she munches through that. Isn't that lovely? Come on now, pull that big root for us. Here we go. Just digging it out a little bit further. Oh. She did that very easily. They seem to enjoy the roots from the bush willows. That seems to be the most sort of, between them and the marula trees. Just in my opinion, that seems to be their favorite roots to feed on. So they must have quite a high water content in them and lots of nutrients. There's a tiny little elephant coming out, also quite curious as to what this adult is doing. Perhaps it's her calf. And I think this little one is wondering, and probably quite jealous, thinking, oh, when I'm big enough, I can't wait to be able to do that. Little one, I think that's a little bit out of your field. Yes, that smaller one seems to be better suited. Now, as we watch this little one, you can see it's struggling to really control its trunk. And you see how it's going in and trying to actually bite the root off with its teeth. Now, that's a strategy that we see the youngest elephants doing, so it's probably just less than 6 months old. But you'll get there one day. There's no point in rushing life. Just take your time and learn every day, little elephant, and eventually you'll get as big and strong as Mom. It's very difficult, though. It's like a piece of spaghetti. I'm just looking at this little elephant's face, and it doesn't look like he's too impressed with, of course, the roots, and probably wondering what the fuss is all about. But of course, he hasn't quite eaten the nice tasty bits just yet. And even if Mom were to break off a small bit for this young calf, I don't know if it would be able to chew it quite well just yet either. I think it's still feeding on the softer vegetation. Ellies are very calm and collected, and I think that they're enjoying the cooler weather today, as the last couple of days have been very, very hot and humid. But they have forecasted a small chance of rain today. We'll see. We'll take any little bit we can get, of course. But for the moment, it doesn't look like it. The skies are very grey. We know how much all the animals enjoy the rain, especially the elephants, because that means more mud wallows. I suppose you could say that the buffalo then enjoy them too. But you can see there's grey sky, but it's not particularly thick clouds, and they're quite high up still, so they'll need to drop a bit. It seems as though these two are going to feed you for quite some time. We have been watching this female as she digs up the roots. Now, Shamsin, you were wondering, in terms of muscles, which is stronger, their feet or their trunk? Now, in my opinion, I think that the feet and the trunk do two completely different things. Obviously, that trunk is very much coordinated, and they're able to control it and move it around and sort of pick up and pull things. Of course, that trunk is very, very strong. Especially when there are branches that are high up and they are able to use their entire body weight by pulling down to snap the branches. But even when they push trees over, they don't directly use their trunk. They sort of curl their trunk above their head and then push against the tree like that using their body strength. So I'm going to have to say, I think that their feet, their legs are probably the strongest. You saw how she would try and pull the root up, and she wouldn't be successful with her trunk, so she would resort to loosening the soil with her foot and then wedging it at the back of her heel and then pulling back, and that would snap it quite easy. Now, you've seen this other girl come in and sort of push that female away. And two little calves here now. So possibly she's higher up in the matriarchal hierarchy, so she gets preference over anything, even if it was the female on the right that did the hard work and pushed this bush willow over. That doesn't matter. You have to respect your elders, even if that means going to find another tree to push over and dig up some more roots. Now, the calf on the left, you can see, is substantially older than the one on the right. You can just see by the height. And let's see if it's able to also pick up a couple of roots. You can actually see it's digging for itself now. It was shuffling its feet around. So already it has learnt that if you want to try and dig the roots up, you need to move your feet around. Probably not quite sure just yet as why it's moving its feet around. But it's seen Mom do that. Oh, look at the injury that it has on its trunk. Can you see that? Now, I wonder what would have caused something like that. It doesn't look too serious, though. And most of the wounds we see on animals, it won't be. Looks like it could have been an abscess. What do you think, Brian?
Yeah, maybe.
You see how it's slightly swollen? I don't know if it was a thorn or something that punctured into the trunk of this little alien, and perhaps a thorn got stuck in there, and often the abscesses will form around it. And maybe it burst some time ago and now it's healing. Abscesses are very, very common with animals, especially something like an elephant. You often see them getting lumps and bumps on their sort of sides, and often it's from a thorn or something penetrating through that thick skin and breaking off at the base, and then it gets stuck in there. And naturally, an abscess is to try and sort of form a protection over that wound, of course, but it does fester and then it will burst. And of course, all that gory stuff will come out, which is good, and then it tends to heal. So maybe it's that, but of course, I don't know. We can only speculate. We didn't see the injury happen. It could be something else, but the most important thing is that it's not serious. You could see it didn't affect that little elephant being able to use its trunk. So it'll be okay. Now, dark tranquility, seeing as though we've got a very good view of these elephants' feet at the moment, you were wondering, do elephants ever break off of their toenails, or do they get any infections in them? I've never known or read anything or seen any documentaries about infections of the nails, but we know as humans that it's quite easy to get a type of a fungal infection on your nails. But if you look at their toenails, they're sort of quite dense and thick, and unlike ours, I don't know if there's sort of a gap, or as sensitive as a gap if you just look at our fingernails, how you're able to, if you clip your nails, of course, you obviously get the extended bit that we can cut that doesn't have any nerve endings in it. There's also opportunity for things to sort of penetrate underneath our nails. Now, I don't know if it's the same with an elephant. I've never touched an elephant before. I've never even had the opportunity to look at an elephant's feet really close up. There we go. Definitely working hard for those roots. But there's always a possibility, and I think just as they're walking around, they're obviously filing those nails down. It's the same thing with the horses, with the zebras and the wildebeest and everything that's got hooves out in the bush. As they're moving around, all the different substrates act as a natural nail file. And I always just find it incredible how something like a zebra or even wild horses don't need to have their hooves sort of tended to by a farrier. Whereas if you look at horses for competition, that's something that you get done quite regularly. It depends if they're serious competition horses. But I remember we used to get our horses' feet done every second month or so. The farrier would come around and clip the hooves and clean them out. but they look quite robust and tough. And I think their feet are very important to an elephant. And they're covered with that thick hide as well. And of course, all the padding underneath their foot. So I think it would be quite difficult for them to get something like that. Now, Kathy, you're wondering why are their feet so flat and round? Now, the wider the base of the foot, the better surface area that elephant has to sort of travel. So remember, these elephants are also massive. So they need a wide surface to sort of hold all of that body weight. I don't think it would be very difficult for that elephant to balance. I think if it had hooves, for instance, like a giraffe. And I don't think they would be able to carry all of that weight. So they've evolved so that they're wider. And also with the different substrates that they're walking over. If they're walking over sandy areas, an elephant would probably find it much easier to walk through a sandy area rather than an impala, because an impala's got tiny little hooves and they would just sink into the sand. But this way, when the elephant puts its foot down, it doesn't sink straight into the sand. It should sort of walk onto the top of the surface. It's like we're walking in snow. You often put, what are those things called, Brian, that you put on your feet when you walk? I have no idea what the word is. Possibly you could help me out there. But they look like either. Tennis rackets. Yeah. We don't have any snow down here. I've never seen snow before. How crazy is that? So I don't know the lingo. And that's exactly what an elephant foot does, is it is able to walk on these softer surfaces without sinking right down, even regardless sort of their weight, of course. But you can learn every day, Archie, so maybe you can teach me something this morning. If you can tell me what those large tennis racket-like things are that you put on your feet when you go walking in the snow, please let me know what they are so I don't call them tennis rackets anymore. You can either do that by hashtagging Safari Live on Twitter, or you can even send an email to questions@wildearth.tv, and Kirsty will kindly feed the word in my ear to save myself from further embarrassment. You can see, look at that elephant now, twisting and turning its trunk, not bothered by that little injury at all. Aren't you beautiful? Look at all those wrinkles. See, it's healing. Now, I don't know if you saw when that elephant opens its mouth how its tusks are just starting to protrude. We'll see if it turns its head again. Now, it's still got quite a bit of growing to do before it reaches the surface. See them there? Look at that. You see those little gaps where those tusks are going to come out? There it is. So this is what I say. So they start growing them from a very early age, but it takes almost 2 years before we'll be able to see them with the naked eye without them having to open their mouths at quite close quarters. That is fantastic. Look at those folds of skin. And that's often what gets quite itchy with the elephants. You know, if you saw, there's sort of skin that forms around that tusk. And quite often you'll find the elephants sort of curling their trunks back to the top of their heads and then rubbing their tusks on a branch or something along those lines. And I can imagine that must get quite itchy, especially if there's dust and things going in there, like this elephant is obviously covering itself with now. Now, Jason, you were wondering if a snake could penetrate through an elephant's skin. I think it would depend on where on the body, because we see elephants going through some very nasty thorns and coming off with sort of a surface scratch, almost like if you were to take your nail and scratch your arm, you get that sort of white coloration on it. So I'm not sure. I've never seen elephants with snake bites before. Maybe their skin is just too thick. If a snake had to bite it on the foot, I don't know, because their skin can be quite a few centimeters thick in certain areas. If a snake were to bite an elephant, I think on the ear, then yes, that is very, very thin, sensitive skin, and I reckon that they would probably then, yes, be affected by the venom. But maybe you've read something or watched something where elephants have been bitten. I've never really come across it before. Maybe even on the tip of the trunk, because that's quite sensitive. If it got sort of bitten inside where the little fingers are, maybe. But otherwise, I think those feet are really hard and robust. I just want to listen to the game drive radio very quickly, just because I can hear some chatter. I can't understand what anyone's saying because they're speaking fluent Shangaan. And unfortunately, I'm not blessed like James, and I can't speak it as well as James can, of course. You can speak Xhosa a little bit better. Yes, I'm ready for my tennis racket shoes. The proper word, thanks, Kirst. Snowshoes, Kirsty, that wasn't complicated. I had to listen very carefully because I was under the impression that it was going to be some long word. So that is obviously very obvious. So thank you so much. And I hope you had a good chuckle at my tennis racket shoes. But there we go, snowshoes. So everybody that helped out in correcting me, I've learned something new today. So thank you very much. And when I do decide to come and visit the States or I go somewhere where there's snow, I won't be embarrassed by walking into a shop and asking for those tennis racket shoes anymore. And I can imagine that whoever would be working in a shop like that would probably laugh hysterically at me, and that would be very embarrassing. So thank you so much for saving me. I shall now remember that. Snowshoes. Now, we're going to continue a search for the Nkuhumas. I'm going to have a chat with a few of the guides now. But I believe that Byron has safely arrived on the plains of the cheetah.
Ooh, not yet, everyone. We're on cheetah plains. We just haven't got to the plains yet. We're just moving around, dodging some trees that the elephants have pushed over. And I'm going to have to move this aerial. Otherwise, I might get an aerial in the eye. Oh, these brakes this morning. It's one way to wake up. There we go. That's a bit better. Oh. Nice to spend some time with those elephants, with Taylor. I'm jealous. I love elephant. It's always great to see them and spend time with them. I can't believe how cool this weather is. James, you say that you heard or read that Mala reported that the cheetah males that do occur in this area tried to bring down a young buffalo calf that had been abandoned, and that could definitely happen, which is interesting. And I wonder, but you say they failed. Did they fail? Anyway, it's very interesting, but it just shows you how opportunistic those cheetah are. Even though, you know, buffalo is not prey that they would generally go for, because it is so, they are so big. But a young calf that's been abandoned, those cheetah brothers would go for it. But, the fact that they weren't successful just shows you probably why the cheetah don't hunt young buffalo. A bit too big, a bit too powerful for them, perhaps. But that is very, very interesting. And those of you who are wondering where Mala is, it's basically, I'm driving north at the moment on this road. Mala is directly south of this, of Cheetah Plains. So directly behind us at the moment. It's one of the largest properties within the Sabi Sands. The three largest areas are Mala, Londolozi and Singita. They all have very, very large areas, and they do not traverse with other properties. They have basically got sole use to their individual properties. Except Londolozi and Singita, they do overlap slightly if they want to. They've got an agreement, but they do not have, like these areas, there are a few more lodges which share land, so they're all very different. Just say good morning to everyone here and see if there's an update. Morning, everybody. How are you? Not yet.
Okay.
Just kind of come through.
You got
exactly. All right, everyone. See you later. Cheers. Good luck. Happy hunting. Some guests on their morning safari. It's always nice to see people out enjoying it. It's funny, but I guide a lot and I take people on safari often. It's so nice to see guests out and enjoying it and having fun. And I'll often stop and just chat to them and ask how it's going and what have they seen. Tourism plays such a huge role in Africa, and it's very, very important. So they also have not seen anything yet, but the fact that we check in these areas together, we may become lucky later. Carrie, you wanted to know if we scan or track and try and find snares in the area, perhaps. So, Carrie, fortunately, these areas are well controlled. There are anti-poaching units which patrol the areas and that. But also, with us being out and tracking and looking for animals and walking through the bush, if we do come across any snares, we'll obviously take them out. So, while we are out looking for the animals, we also look for things like that. But excuse me, I've never come across snares in this area at all. I think if anything, you probably get them on the outskirts of the game reserve, right on the edge, close to the fence line, where the communities, some people from the communities may get in and try set up snares. That could potentially happen, but within the center of these game reserves and the center of the park, chances of finding snares are very, very slim. Oh, some more impala, everybody, off to our right. Sue in Wisconsin, you wanted to know, have vehicles ever hit animals while on safari? If it has happened, Sue, I haven't heard of it. I wouldn't be surprised if it has happened. But I think generally speaking, no. However, animals have hit vehicles, so the other way around. And we know with elephants charging vehicles, rhino, buffalo, I know of a few incidents and people who have been charged by those animals. I think a little bit of it is because they get themselves into situations that they probably shouldn't have. But the bush is unpredictable. The animals can be unpredictable at times. So you've got to always be careful. But yeah, I don't know if I know of anyone that's hit anything. I'll maybe ask around a little bit and see if anyone else has heard of something. But it's unlikely because, to be honest, we're driving very slowly, Sue, and we're scanning. And even if the antelope run and dart in front of the vehicles, it's usually easy just to quickly slam brakes and they'll run right past. So there's very little chance of hitting something unless you're just speeding and driving recklessly. Cindy from all the way from North Carolina, good morning to you, Cindy, or good evening, rather, for you. You want to know if we can see some ostrich today, and that I need to find you ostrich, so I'll try my best. I haven't seen ostrich here for quite some time, but it would be wonderful to see some. There was a wonderful story of an ostrich south of here, so actually on Londolozi. And this female ostrich was around for 2-3 years, I think, she was around, and completely alone, a very lonely life. And it was funny, after a while, she started to get used to the vehicles, and this female ostrich would come up and walk right next to the vehicles, stand and come and investigate the people in the vehicle, and then start picking at the rubber and the dashboard. And she'd just pick at it, and she'd hang around, and she'd fluff her feathers, and she'd do this little ostrich dance, and then move off again. And she did that for a long time. And it was wonderful. Earlier this year, a few months ago, two male ostriches came running through the area. They must have come in from the Kruger. Came running through, and these males were basically challenging one another for dominance, and the one managed to chase the other one off and mated with that female ostrich, and she laid eggs, I think it was about 2 months ago, if I'm not mistaken. She laid eggs, and they did hatch, and I find this fascinating. Oh, sorry everyone. I think what we're going to do is we're going to drive down here rather. So what had happened was the eggs did hatch despite the eggs and the nest being raided by hyena. And we got to see a few of the eggs being scattered around, and a hyena tried to raid the nest. Don't know, I can't remember if they actually got some of the eggs, but the ostriches gathered them together again and continued to incubate them. And amazingly enough, a number of them actually hatched, which was fantastic. But I believe there's only 2 or 3 left at the moment. But they are still around, these little chicks. Are there 4 left, Dina? You've just sent through a comment. 4 little ostrich chicks left. Just saw some vultures here, everyone. Have a look. There is still one in this dead tree just off to the right. You may see it now. There we go. White-backed vulture. So that's interesting, Dina. So there are 4 of them left. That's wonderful. So these little ostriches are moving through the area, which is great. I wonder if that female is still so friendly, and if she still walks up to the vehicles. It'll be interesting with the little chicks. But they are strange animals, and you'd think, you know, that it's just nice to see an ostrich, and they're interesting looking animals, and all these birds that walk around, and you don't really get to see how big they are until those ostriches get next to the vehicle. They're massive. They really are big animals. And these, I mean, the ostriches too, they're quite intimidating, because they'll go and they'll pick at things, and they've got these massive, massive toes and claws. And they can do some serious damage if they had to kick you. So it is it's an intimidating bird, that's for sure, when you do get very close. Wonder what, I think, to be honest, everyone, I think these vultures have been possibly just roosting in these dead trees for the evening. Maybe starting to move off now. It's not to say that there's definitely a kill in the area. Just having a look around to see if I see any movement on the ground, but I don't see anything just yet. What is, hang on, there's some zebra off to our right. Let me just see if I can get us a little bit closer. Moving through the thicket. So just because you see some vultures in a tree doesn't necessarily mean there is definitely a kill around. Could be, but also they do roost together and they look for dead trees. So that is why I think all those vultures were probably just in those trees this morning. Hang on, let's see if we can see some zebra. Maybe through here, Dave. There we go. Oh, wonderful. A dazzle of zebra. They're looking in good condition, actually. I say that, but it's always difficult to tell if zebra are in good condition or not. The reason is because of their digestive system, they are known as hind gut fermenters, so they bulk feeders, and what happens is because of this digestive system, they build up a lot of gas, and their bodies swell slightly. So the zebra always look as if they are big and healthy, or fat and healthy, but occasionally it may not be the case. It's purely because of the gases building up within their body, and you can hear it if they do run. You'll hear the zebra's gas build up, that's for sure. And they're enjoying this green grass, this bit of green grass that's around at the moment. Mary from Colorado, thank you for your comment. And you say you can see I do love the bush, and I do indeed. And you wanted to know if there are any other areas that I'd like to guide in or go to see. I'm trying to think, Mary. I think because I know Africa so well and love all the wildlife here, I think a different ecosystem, which I would like to get to and hopefully sometime soon in the future, would be up into East Africa, into Kenya and Tanzania, the Masai Mara. It's slightly different, even though it is still Africa, but it is a slightly different ecosystem. I'd like to get up there and see that. There's something about South America which intrigues me. I'd like to perhaps see part of South America, perhaps the Pantanal. You know, you get to see jaguars out there if you're lucky, and the wildlife there is also very fascinating. So perhaps South America. And where else? I'd like to go to Madagascar. Madagascar is very different. You've got lemurs and strange creatures out there, so perhaps Madagascar. And where else? I mean, a friend of mine and I always used to speak about seeing snow leopards, and that would be wonderful. Love to see snow leopards. See the tails constantly moving, keeping flies away. A lovely cool breeze this morning. I must admit, this cool weather is so welcome because it's been very, very hot. So to have to wear a jacket while out on drive is very, very nice. Makes a difference. It's funny, the rooms, however, that we stay in still manage to seem to keep their warmth. They're still very, very warm. And the fans, and you can hear from all the different rooms in the DRC where we stay, the fans blow constantly during the day and at night. And James got a well-deserved rest this morning. He's sleeping in a little bit. I'm sure he's awake by now already, but I hope he got to rest a little bit. We're going to continue towards the plains. While I do that, let's head back to Taylor, get an update, and see how she's doing finding the Nkuhuma Pride.
We haven't had had much luck yet with the Nkuhumas, but we've got, there are a couple of guards that are sort of helping us out, and I haven't seen any more footprints. I still couldn't work out where those other tracks went. However, I believe that from the other afternoon, we very briefly saw a buffalo disappearing down and towards Bifulsuk Dam, and I believe that unfortunately it has passed on, which is quite sad to hear. I did hear quite a few hyenas calling last night when I was awake, trying to cool down in the early hours of the morning. So let's go sort of straight towards Bifulsuk Dam. We're on Hyena Road at the moment, and go and have a look and see if there's anything happening around there. Hopefully there will be something exciting, and maybe we even bump into the Nkuhumas on the way, but I haven't seen anything just yet. Now, we had a few little spits of rain, but it was pathetic rain, really. It was just sort of, if you did that with your tongue and you put your hand in front of your face, that's the type of droplets we were feeling. But it's more than what we had earlier. Oh, you never know. Perhaps we are going to get a bit of rain. It does look like there's some bad weather coming from the west. I'm going to check here. There's lots of footprints, but lots of footprints of impala and zebra moving around here. Ooh, what are you? Orioles. Let's see if we've got a black-headed oriole. We can see. I can hear one. He's up in here. Let's be sneaky. Can you see him in there? Oh no, he's just dropped. There he goes. Let's see. Oh, we're going to get a view of him because he's sitting out in the open now. No, sit onto the top of the branch. He's hang on, I think we make there. Is that the gap? Oi. There he is. Listen to that beautiful call. And off he goes. And it seems like there's an elephant just feeding to the right of him. I actually didn't even see him. He's hidden so well in the distance. Is that in there? Yeah, look at that. The only reason I spotted that elephant was because I actually heard him, or she, I don't know who it is. There seems to be quite a few of them coming out of the thicket. We might be having an elephant day today. I think so far, we've seen in the thicket about three different herds of elephants, which is fantastic because, like I said, a couple of days ago, or for the last week or so, we haven't really been seeing the breeding herds, just a few members. But let's carry on. Let's not get too distracted, as I'd like to go towards Bifulsuk Pan. But let's go over there. Hi, elephants. If we see some more elephants that have come out of the bushes, we'll definitely have a little look at them. Now, I know that Byron was chatting about different places that he'd like to work, and a place that I'd like to work or guide again in is Zambia. I very much enjoyed Zambia. Anywhere in Zambia would be fantastic. Okay. Let me just quickly. Okay, copy. I'm on Hyena Road almost at the fire break, so I think I'm closer. I'll quickly check Bifulsuk Dam. I know there's that dead buffalo in the watering hole. Right, so it seems as though Taxon has picked up some more tracks a little bit further west though, on Central of the Lions Crossing. So they obviously crossed through that drainage. Sorry, I almost fell out of the vehicle there. I almost got attacked by a thorn tree, and then I went into a little hole as well. It was great fun. Sorry for that. But I think we're gonna head straight to Bifulsuk Dam. But I'm also scanning as we're going through here, because possibly they have gone towards that buffalo. I didn't see any tracks though so far on Hyena Road, but this road is also not the greatest for tracking, as it's got quite a bit of clay in the soil, and the ground seems to be very hard at the moment with only a couple of sandy patches. Well, let's get around there very quickly. We're not far now. Maybe we get lucky and we find them first. Okay, so it seems like this is quite interesting now. So what we're doing is, it sounds like Taxon is going all the way towards Inyala North, and hopefully there's somewhere between where we are now and Bifulsuk Dam and Inyala Road. see. It's quite a long road. And it's quite a tricky patch if they do go down there, especially if they're going to the drainage, because it's quite thick, even thicker than the drainage line that sort of runs east-west between Central and Twin Dams Road. Now, everybody's got the same idea as us. They also think that they've gone towards that dead buffalo, which is unusual when it comes to the Nkuhumas, because you know what they're like. They seem to prefer to take down their own buffalo. But maybe they wouldn't have been so picky. Maybe they're struggling a little bit now. Let's head there quickly. Let's just check the tracks. Right, nothing, just lots of impala again. Now, I had a strange dream the other night, and perhaps some of you can maybe help me. And in my dream, there was this massive leopard. Now, it was a leopard that I've never seen before. Perhaps I've seen a photo of it, but I'm not sure where. It is a leopard that one of it seemed to be blind in one eye. I couldn't tell you which eye it was, but it was murky. And I don't know if it's because I've seen a picture, or if there is, or if I've made it up, or if there is actually a leopard in the sands that's like that. But maybe you can help me in identifying my mysterious leopard for my dream. It's been bothering me now for the last couple of days. I'm desperately trying to figure out who it is. You can just pop it a little hashtag Safari Live with an answer if there is one. Otherwise, you can just tell me that I'm talking nonsense and I'm making strange things up in my head at night. Okay, we're almost at Buffalsoek Dam. Just scan here quickly. Still haven't seen any tracks coming through though, so they must have jumped across the road. Ooh. It's getting colder, hey Brian? Might have to add another jacket, a waterproof one, to keep the wind off of me. Right, we're going to turn down one of the entrances to Buffalsoek Dam. Whee! Okay, here we go. Oh my goodness, rusty. Now, of course, you also all need to keep your eyes open in case you spot the lions before I do. Here we go. Fingers crossed. Fingers crossed for hyenas or lions. Okay. Who have we got here? We're going to just drive up a little bit. We're going to just go to an open view so we can scan and check the entire dam nicely. Are you ready? Right, here we are. And I can't see anything just yet. I can see a hippopotamus. And of course, you can see that buffalo just on the other side of the dam. But it doesn't look like anything has eaten it yet, except there's a terrapin by its tail. Can you see those terrapins moving around there? I think that they are pulling the ticks off of that buffalo. There's quite a few of them around. But we'll try and go around and get a closer look, because that'll be quite interesting to watch those terrapins. So no hyenas, and it doesn't look like there's any lions either. But it looks like Henry, the hippopotamus, is here. Hello, Henry. Are you a bit miserable because it's cold this morning? He doesn't look very happy, does he? Henry, I must be honest, I'd prefer to have a cooler day than that hot sun, especially because you don't have a nice tree to provide you with some shade. You should really think about moving into Chelepan. It's quite nice and homely there, and it doesn't look occupied. Not interested. Okay, fine. Don't take my advice then. That's okay. Maybe he's not very happy that there's a buffalo sharing his watering hole with him now. But let's go around. Let's go a little bit further forward because I'm quite keen to watch those terrapins do their thing and pull the ticks off. That's something we don't get to see all the time. Now, Jin V, Anna and Michael, thank you very much. You've given me a clue as to who this leopard could be. You've said that it could have been a leopard by the name of Safari, who was Karula's mother. And apparently her one eye was sort of milky. And that's exactly what it looked like. It looked like she was blind in one eye and it was milky. So I didn't make that up, but that's bizarre. I didn't even know who Karula's mother was. It's quite interesting. And you can see that's the tip of the horn sticking out of the water. Now maybe because there's the terrapin coming back again. You can see its head just popping up to, there it is. Watch this. Look at it, it's going for that tick. Can you see that tick there? You're going to have to find some that are a bit closer to the surface of the water, little one. Now, terrapins don't ever really get an opportunity to do this because when the buffalo is alive or any animal, is and they sort of try and pull the ticks off. Of course, the buffalo, the whatever it may be, will actually jump up and sort of move out of the water. It's obviously not quite nice. So it's a good meal for these ticks, for these terrapins. So even though it's quite sad that this buffalo has now died in the watering hole, it's providing a meal not for someone you would have expected, not for the hyenas at the moment, not for the lions or the jackals or the vultures just yet, but for the terrapins. And can you see all the bubbles coming from sort of the nose of the buffalo? And Lucy, I know that you actually pointed it out that it's blowing bubbles. Now what that probably is it's probably the gases. It's sort of coming out of this buffalo now. Very, very slowly. That's probably what's going on there. All the methane gas building up inside of it. You can see its stomach has swelled quite a bit. And I reckon if the hyenas do find this, they will probably drag it out of the water. But we're going to continue our search for the Nkuhumas. What was that? Did you hear that? Was it elephants? Okay, I'm just checking because I'm now on edge because the lions could be around. But we're going to continue our search. Let's go to Byron with a warthog.
We've got a beautiful big male warthog. And I can tell it's a male just by looking at the face, everyone. Can you see? Well, firstly, those big tusks. But males and females have got tusks. But the warts, so have a look there. The male's got 4 warts on his face, 2 up around the eye and 2 lower down on the snout. And whereas a female only has 2. There you can see this male has got 4. So easy to identify a male warthog just by looking at the face. 4 warts as opposed to the 2 that the females have. And this one's really, really relaxed, which is wonderful. Quite a big male. And you can see those big tusks. They would probably do some serious damage. Nick 1011, you wanted to know, are there meerkats which walk around with the warthogs? No, they are not. That is only in the Lion King, unfortunately. That does not happen out here. And we also don't have meerkats in this area at all, Nick. They occur in semi-arid to desert areas. So much drier terrain than this. We do not have meerkats in the Kruger, in the greater Kruger, this northeastern part of South Africa at all. Down in the Eastern Cape, so the central or south central part of South Africa, a lot of meerkats around there, and then also up in the northwestern part in the deserts,
That's where you generally see meerkats. You do not get them down around this area. And even when they are around, you don't see them with warthogs. They don't walk around with warthogs. As I said, that's purely Lion King. It does not happen in the wild. So we're actually right up against the boundary with the Kruger National Park, and everything, well, directly behind that warthog. So everything, all those trees, you can see there's a bit of a road through there. This is the Kruger, or the boundary between the Sabi Sands and the Kruger National Park. And as you can see, there are no fences, so the animals can move freely between the areas, and we've said that before. So this, that's why this is one of the largest national parks in Africa, and the Greater Kruger is about 3.2 million hectares, or roughly around 7 million acres altogether. It does extend a bit into Mozambique as well as into Zimbabwe. So it is a very, very large area. We've got a question from, I think it's Duck Rat Dave, I hope I'm saying that correctly, but you wanted to know if there are any tribes which hunt around this area, or are allowed to hunt around this area, local tribes. And look, just quickly, look at all the mud on that warthog. It's been wallowing in some mud probably yesterday when it was so hot, and that mud has just caked a little bit on the warthog. Anyway, you wanted to know if there are any tribes which are allowed to hunt in these areas, like up in East Africa. The Maasai that do occur in those national parks are entitled to hunt, because that is they've basically lived there their whole lives. So not in these areas, and the reason is because this has been turned into a national park, and also a lot of communities have moved out and moved on into the outskirts of the of these areas. So, and most of the communities around here farm with livestock, cattle, sheep, goats. So that's where they get a lot of their food from. So they don't have to hunt anymore. But there's no hunting which goes on within these national parks anymore. Especially not from local tribes. There are no local tribes within these areas. Up in Botswana and that, you probably still get the San, the Bushmen. They do still occur up in those areas and up in Namibia, so they would still hunt in those areas and survive off the land, but not here, not where we are. Defender, you asked if I've ever had warthog bacon before. No, I haven't, but I have eaten warthog before, and it's tasty, it's very tasty, but I've never tried warthog bacon. I would imagine it's pretty good. Have you tried it, Dave?
No, I'd like to.
You'd like to, huh? I think it would be quite tasty, but I have eaten warthog, and they are tasty. A lot of the venison or game meat which we get in South Africa is very, very tasty, especially antelope species, very, very nice to eat. This warthog's been very, very relaxed with us being around. Thank you, sir. Let's continue and see what else we can find. Maybe a pangolin or an aardvark. Who knows? Corey, you wanted to see, or you'd love to see, a serval, and have I seen one recently? Corey, I haven't seen serval for quite some time, and I have seen in the Sabi Sands, I've seen serval before a few times, but I can't remember the last time I saw one. I'd also love to see a serval. Beautiful cat. see what else we can find. This weather hasn't changed much. If anything, it's just got a bit cooler. Felt a few drops earlier. We thought maybe it was going to rain, but I think it was just threatening. It doesn't look like serious rain clouds or anything, just very overcast. Just approaching another clearing over here. Let's see what else we can find. And we do know there are those side-striped jackal which we see occasionally on cheetah plains. Would be nice to see them around again. Maybe, if we're lucky. Julie, you want to know where animals like the warthog, for example. Firstly, let's answer that one, where the warthogs sleep. So, Julie, the warthogs have got dens or burrows, which they use, and they use it. It'll usually be inside a termite mound, an abandoned termite mound. And that's where those warthogs, what they do is, it's actually incredible to see. So either in abandoned termite mounds or burrows in the hole, what they do is they actually reverse down and they climb down backwards into the holes. And one of the main reasons is for safety. So they've got those sharp tusks like we just saw on that warthog. And if they do feel threatened in any way, they'll come out very, very quickly and they can charge whatever it is that threatens them. Appears as if there's some maintenance going on around here. Sandy from Canada, you want to know if there's a curfew. Sorry, let me just see. I think they're working in this whole area. We're going to have to go around, everyone. They're possibly just trying to fix a dam, perhaps. I think that's what they're doing over here. Looks like it. Sandy, you want to know if there's a curfew around for driving at night? Oh, just got a wonderful, wonderful smell, everyone. And what it is aniseed, wild aniseed that I've just driven over. And the best way to describe it is that licorice smell, wild aniseed. And that's what I've just driven over now. And there's quite a lot of it here. It's very small, but it's probably just coming out and growing at the moment because of all that rain. Wonderful smell. So, Sandy, there is a curfew in these areas, and it's obviously for anti-poaching purposes, to make sure that vehicles aren't just wandering around at night. And if you do contact anti-poaching units in your area, you could possibly stay out a little bit longer, but within the Sabi Sand, the general rule is 10:30 in the evening. You have to be back in camp by 10:30. So there is a curfew. And we're lucky that it's that late. Some areas, like within the Kruger National Park, it's even earlier. You've got to be back in the camp, I think. And again, it's because the Kruger National Park's open to the public. So you can take your own vehicles and you can self-drive through the national park. But the camps that you stay in are very strict. You have to be back in the camp. And I think it's around 6:30 perhaps, now in summer, 6:30. Maybe 7, I'm not sure, that you then have to be back in the camp, and then you can only leave at a certain time in the morning. And I think again now in summer the time is about 5 a.m. that you're allowed to leave the camp. So there are gates that get closed, and those camps are fenced in to obviously protect the general public. It's very windy today, everyone. And I think that's possibly why we haven't seen too much wildlife. And you can probably hear in my microphone, but when it is so windy and it is a bit colder, the animals do react to the weather, and they will, or they may move deeper into some thickets to try and get some shelter, get out of the wind, because also it's difficult for them to hear or smell predators if they are around. So they'll try and move out of the wind as much as possible. Sorry, brakes again. I just saw something interesting that I just wanted to chat about. Just off to the left, everyone. Hang on. There we go. Dave will show you. Look at this carcass. Well, the remains of a carcass. It's a very old carcass, and I can tell it's old because it's been spread out, and those bones you can see have been gnawed at by some other animals and completely spread out. So it is an old carcass, and this is a buffalo carcass. You can tell it's very large bones in that, and there is also a buffalo skull around here that's just off to the right. We'll show you that shortly. Just over there you can see the buffalo carcass, or the skull rather. But why I wanted to stop here is just to explain something quite interesting, some animal behavior, and it's a pity we haven't seen it for quite some time. But these carcasses play a vital role for a lot of animals. And I say that because obviously a lot of predators get to feed on it. So most likely what would have happened is perhaps the lions killed this buffalo, so they got to feed on it. Then you have the scavengers, which will come around. So perhaps hyena, maybe the jackal, maybe some other little creatures, a civet or a honey badger, perhaps, maybe, you know, just picking on little bits and pieces that are around. And then the vultures. And then obviously like little carrion beetles and that type of stuff, that those little insects that will feed on these carcasses. So a lot benefits from these carcasses and from dead animals. But another thing that is interesting is some of the herbivores will also benefit from this. And one of the animals which will most definitely benefit from this is giraffe. Now, some of you might be thinking, how will a giraffe benefit from this? The giraffe will come and actually bend down and pick up some of these bones and chew on the bone. Now, that is a process known as osteophagia. It's the eating of bone. And giraffes do it because they need the calcium and the phosphorus, which is very important for the growth of their own bones. And that's why a lot of the time you'll see with older giraffe, they do get a lot of calcification around the head on those ossicones, those horns on the giraffe, and around the back of the head and that. And so they do feed on the bone, or they chew on the bone to get the phosphorus and the calcium. They're not the only ones. There are some smaller antelope species that do it. And it's fascinating to see. So it's, as I said, it's known as osteophagia, and it's very important. Animals will do it to get nutrients that they need to survive. So even herbivores will benefit from a carcass like this. And it reminds me of a funny story. I was once driving guests, and they were a little bit nervous to be on safari. It was their first time, which is understandable. You know, you don't really know much about the area and what to expect. And while we were driving around, this lady kept asking, you know, every time we saw something, she was like, you know, are those animals going to charge? Will they attack us? And it, you know, it would be like antelope, maybe wildebeest or kudu. And I'd keep reassuring her, saying, no, we are completely safe. Don't worry. And then we came around the corner and we saw some giraffe. And she said, oh, what about the giraffe? I said, no, don't worry. The giraffe are also herbivores. We don't have to worry about them. They'll also move away from us. The animals aren't out here to get us. And these herbivores especially, they don't eat meat. And they, you know, they feed off the leaves and off plant material. We don't have to worry. She said, okay. And we continued driving, and I promise you it must have been 5 minutes later. We came around the corner, and there was this beautiful big male giraffe standing in the middle of the road, and it had an entire impala skull, just the top part of the skull, actually, with these horns sticking out of its mouth. This giraffe was chewing on the bone and looking at us, and the lady got such a fright, and she shouted at me. She said, "You're lying to me. This giraffe clearly eat the impala. What's going on?" to explain that afterwards was very fun, but it was just purely to chew on some of the bone. But to see these horns coming out of the giraffe's mouth was very, very funny. We're going to start making our way back, I think, just driving through Cheetah Plains, still having a look around to see if we don't bump into anything. While I do that, let's head back to Taylor and see if she's had any luck with the lions.
We have indeed had some luck with the lions. It was fantastic that Taxon found them on Gwarri Pan Road, so we're making our way there. We're not far now, and this is what it helps so much to have more than one person trying to track down the animals, because you're able to check twice as many roads. So thank goodness for Taxon. So they must have just been jumping across from drainage line to drainage line, and well, he got lucky. Now we need to get on down there. We need to get off Hippo Pools Road, and we'll have to go all the way around again. That's okay, but we've got some zebra up ahead. Hi, zebra. I shall show you the zebra. It's lots down this way. Hello, young zebra. And this looks like a foal from probably last year sometime. Off it goes. I think Mama's already on the other side of the road, so it's taking a wide berth. Don't worry, we won't harm you. We just want to look at you and your beautiful stripes. And I always think on the younger zebra, you can see that shadow stripe so much more prominently compared to the adults. It's there, but it seems to be faded away. Aren't those beautiful? Having a stare at us. Hello, lovely. Now it's getting really windy. I can feel a couple more drops coming down. Now Zebra, you better be careful, because I believe there's some lions on the road you were just on. I should probably try and find out which side of Gwarri Pan it is, because I'm sort of in the middle at the moment. Andrew for Taylor. And you just confirm, are those lions closer towards Biffle's Hook Pan side or closer towards Cheetah Cutline side on Gwarri Pan? Copy, Nomatata, I'll be there in a couple of minutes. Okay, so it seems as though we need to actually go on to Drakensberg Road towards Central. So let's get a move on though, because I'm not sure if the animals are moving or not. And well, you know what the Nkuhumas are like. As much as I love them, they do like to walk in some thick vegetation. Occasionally, they behave like Karula. So off we go. Let's go down here. Bye, zebra. See you tomorrow. Woo! It's very cold now. My goodness, and I'm also going to have to just push my hat down. I apologize for the strange noise. Otherwise, it's going to blow off of the top of my head. And I found it so interesting to see all those terrapins eating those ticks. once upon a time you're commenting on the fabulous weather we've been having, and you've said that you find it amazing how it changes so drastically. Well, this is South Africa, and it's very common to actually have all the seasons in one day. So that's, well, even in a 24-hour period, that's quite common. And this almost feels like we're still in September. I've got a stick. The sticks, they like to jump underneath my vehicle. I don't know why. We shall reverse and try and lose it. Get off stick. You are not welcome. I don't think it is. Maybe, yes, I think I lost it. We'll try and not pick it up again. Now, normally in September in this area, you get these drastic weather patterns. One day it's hot, then it's windy and it's cold and there's a bit of rain. Normally as we're edging into October, the weather starts to stabilize a bit, but I suppose we haven't really had proper rain just yet. Well, we'll just have to take it as it comes. I'm going to have a cold day today, and I think tomorrow it warms up a bit, and then they forecasted rain for a couple of days after that. So that's quite exciting for us. We're very excited. So when we go from having those ridiculously hot days, getting almost over 100 degree Fahrenheit, we have them for about a week, and then we have this cold spell, and it's going to continue just until we get a decent amount of rain, and then, well, summer will kick in. You can see we're driving through a massive herd of impala. Bye, impala. We're off to the lions. But let us not digress too much. I'm very good at doing that. I don't think we're too far. Oh, there they are. I've got them. Woo, I thought I saw one. Right, now we're going to try and... Oh, I see what they're looking at. Okay, so there's some... Have a look at that. Can we show everybody the impala very quickly? That are right there. Look at that. Just want to show you the prey. All those impala are not far. Now I'm going to try and move into the sighting with the lions. And I don't know if the impala know that the lions are there just yet. It's quite interesting. And of course we saw that all those other impala that were coming straight towards the lions. So let's try get in here and find a little gap. So I'm just turning the game drive radio off because it makes lots of noises. Sorry, Kirsty, I didn't catch your message for a second there. There was quite a bit of interference. Now, hello, Zakura. Zakura, you're hoping for a morning hunt. Well, at the moment, it looks as though they're all fast asleep, barring one lioness who is showing some interest. There she is. She's laying, watching those impala. But now she doesn't look too interested at all. Now, something small like an impala really would only feed one lion. And with all of these hungry little lions that need to be fed, well, they're probably going to have to try and catch a few. And that's why we see them going for buffalo all the time. Because it does supply them with a meal for about 2 days. And that's what they want to do. They don't want to have to hunt every single day. Of course, if they have to, they will. But remember, they're not very successful hunters. So it's easier to take down a bigger prey item and then be able to feast on that for a couple of days. Oh, look at this little cub being so loving. I'm going to just try and count them quickly. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Oh, all 8 cubs look like they're there. They're all cuddled up, and you can see how cold it is this morning. And I know you're probably laughing at us when we say cold, because, well, it doesn't ever really get cold in South Africa, does it? Well, especially not in this area. And this little cub is trying its luck at waking everybody up. Maybe it's hungry. Now, I don't know when the Nkuhumas last ate. It feels like ages since I last saw them. This is what you call multitasking, of course, licking and scratching yourself at the same time. But the cold weather hasn't chased the flies away. You can see they're still flying around, trying to get the moisture from the eyes and on the nose. And of course that little cub is trying its absolute best to shake them off. Looks like that one has seen the impala now. So I believe that yesterday James was actually saying that it looks like they're not scratching as much, which is fantastic. That means that possibly the mange that some of them have picked up is disappearing, and another lioness has now seen the impala. I'm going to look over my shoulder to see how close they are. They're still about the same distance away, but what I'm interested in is those impala that we saw just before we arrived here, because there's another big herd. There must be a few hundred around here, because they were on the same side of the road as the lions, and they're probably only about 50 meters away from them. And of course, that hunting instinct now clearly showing in that little cub. But that urge is obviously not too strong just yet. I think there's some elephants in the distance as well. I just heard some branches cracking. Sort of behind the lions. They didn't really react to it though. So that could be quite interesting if a herd of ellies come through here. We know how. Oh, let's see. What you gonna do, girl? See how those pupils look like they're starting to dilate now? Yeah, she's getting very excited. Jerky movements, ears perked up. Definitely showing some interest in these impala, but we will wait and see. Just looking back again at the impala. The impala have absolutely no idea these lions are here. Whether it's because they're sort of downwind of the impala, I'm not sure. Can't really feel too much wind. No, thanks, X-Ranger. You've just said that we're on day 61. Isn't that so exciting? Now, I wonder if we're going to make it to day 100. Wouldn't that be incredible? We can all just keep our fingers crossed and see and hope if we can get to day 100 of cats. That'd be quite amazing. But I think the more and more rain that we get, it's going to become more difficult because their food is going to start to scatter. Hello, little one. I haven't seen my little floppy-eared girl just yet, but perhaps she's all cuddled up. There's a few of them, they're all all scrunched up in one little ball. But they're looking lovely and healthy, the Nkuhumas. Their coats look nice and clean. They're looking in brilliant condition. I believe there was a bit of a dispute yesterday about the name Flip Flop. You all know that I'm not for the name Flip Flop. I like to call her the floppy-eared girl, but I've forgotten the name that Amanda told me for sort of cheeky and sassy, something along those lines, because I think that would suit her quite nicely, because Mandleve, which means ear, I think it's taken, and of course you've got that hyena that's named Floppy Ear. So we'll try and change your name. We'll maybe try and get it to something that suits her personality. So this afternoon, I'm going to get Amanda to tell me the name again, but I'm going to write it down, and I'll also write it down phonetically so you can have a look at it, so we can learn how to say it. And well, you can tell me if you think it's a suitable name. I think it's quite nice, but I'm not going to try and say it because I fear that I'm going to mispronounce it. But I think she does deserve a local name that describes her personality. Now, of course, we don't always give the lionesses names, but the reason why I think we should, because she's just so feisty, and of course, she's very distinct looking. Now, you can see this lioness is looking quite lean, which is unusual. We always seem to be seeing the Nkuhumas with big bellies. She's focusing. Taking very slow steps, watching where she puts her feet. There we go, very delicately. She's actually making quite a bit of noise. Come on, girl, you can do it.
the lioness is just having a cat nap at the back. She doesn't seem to be showing too much interest. I'm just gonna turn my volume of my voice down a little bit, which is quite difficult, believe it or not. My dad always said I only had one volume and that was loud growing up. Serves him right for having a house that echoed. She's obviously hungry, and well, she doesn't look too bothered. How many lionesses are here? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Oh, cool. They're all fantastic. All 5 lions are here, which is lovely. I think this is the first time in quite some time that I've seen them all together again. I think it's the young lioness that's the keen huntress. Remember that day we watched her chase after that giraffe? Because she's so young, she is very keen. Remember, she's also still learning various hunting strategies and she's constantly improving. Whereas the other girls have got a couple of years on her. I think it's the young lioness. I didn't see any mammary glands when she was standing. She's a little bit smaller than the other girls too. Big yawn. Oh, look at those lovely teeth. The only problem now with them waiting for so long is that the impala is starting to put a bit of distance between them and they're moving further off into the thicket. Maybe if they're patient enough, that second herd of impala that are not too far away will move in, and they were all over the road and on both sides of the road too, which would be quite interesting. But I haven't seen them just yet. You know what, and I can hear that black cuckoo shrike again in the distance, which is very exciting. Still watching very, very carefully. She hasn't taken her eyes off of those impala. See how she's not even really letting those flies bother her anymore. They're creeping right up to her eye. Normally there, she would have given a head shake, but her mind is elsewhere. Now there are lots and lots of impala here, so she does have that on her side. Those impala are incredibly athletic. They can easily outrun a lion. They don't have the element of surprise, and even just outmaneuver when they leap and bound around. But what I suspect you'll try and do is you'll probably try and rush into the herd and make them scatter. And then by causing a frenzy, she'd probably be able to snatch one that sort of got a bit disorientated and lost. And that's sort of the idea. And we often see them doing that when the impalas have all had their lambs. Those little ones get disorientated quite quickly, so sort of rushing at the prey causes that frenzy, and it allows for one of the other lions or a couple of other lions to have an opportunity to take down something like an impala. And of course this is quite sad, but this is actually a really, really difficult antelope to catch. She's gonna have to be extremely careful and quiet and precise about her movements. Sort of have a little bit more lenience with the buffalo, not being able to run as fast as the impala. It really is a great day course for these lions to perform a hunt, just because of the weather conditions, because of the wind. It's not quite a gentle breeze, it's quite windy, and of course it's nice and overcast. I think Andrew wants to try and sneak out of here. Let's see what he's going to do. He's going to see if he needs me to reposition. I think he's going to take a sneaky way around. So what I'm going to do in a moment is I'm actually going to move forward, because I see that there's another vehicle that is dying to get in here and have a better view. So we'll just wait for Andrew to keep moving, and then I will reposition, which will then allow this other vehicle to come in from behind us. Okay, let's reposition quickly. Now, Ginny in Texas, you're wondering, when those lions do focus on prey, do their pupils dilate? They do indeed. You saw it quite nicely with that one lioness, how her pupils were quite small. And then as soon as she found something that she enjoyed, she liked the look of, those pupils went massive. And that allows more light into their eyes. You can imagine it helps them see and focus better. They're in sort of a tricky spot. There's a lot of thorny trees lying all around them, which is making it difficult for all of us to try and view them. That's where we're fortunate to have this beautiful camera that is situated quite high up, so we can often see above small fallen shrubs. Oh, I'm feeling a couple of raindrops now. Jody, you said that the lions need a 6-pack of antelope to feed them. You're quite right. Maybe even a 12-pack or a case. I'm not sure though. Whether they're actually going to go after these impala, I'm not convinced. There's not enough of them have really shown interest. They're curious. They're looking at them and they're excited by the fact that there are impala around. But like I said, it's a difficult meal, and do they run the risk of attempting to chase that prey and burn through quite a large amount of energy? Or do they wait for something more substantial like a buffalo or a zebra or a kudu? Even the cubs haven't really shown too much interest. Oh, those drops are getting bigger now. Seems as though there's a little nimbostratus cloud coming overhead. Those are typically rain clouds, but I think it's just a low-flying cloud. I don't know how long it's going to last. There's, like I said, it's not much rain. It's gone from spitting to actual droplets. Hello, little one. I don't know what that little one is even watching. I don't think it can see the impala from where it's sitting. Yes, chase that fly. I've been hearing elephants distress calling quite severely, but it sounds like it's in one of the drainage lines near Inyala North. And we heard it from earlier this morning, and I wanted to go and investigate, but then, of course, Taxon managed to find the lions. So we diverted, but I just heard it give a roar again. Now we're going to hang around here for a little bit longer. I think we may at some point have to put the rain covers on. But let's head across to Byron, who has finally found his way back to Juma.
I have indeed found my way back to Juma because we just didn't have any luck this morning on Cheetah Plains. We scanned around and had a look,
but didn't see anything, which happens. It happens at times. So we're going to head back. We're almost on Juma, and have a look around and see what else we can find. Maybe we're lucky and we bump into a leopard somewhere. It would be nice to see that beautiful female Karula and her cubs again. Lisa, we do not get tigers in Africa. Tigers are found in India, not out in Africa. And so we've got other... Can you see that bird up there, Dave? Everyone, let's just have a look. I don't know if Dave's able to get there. I heard something. It's a fish eagle. I thought so. African fish eagle. Yes, nice. I heard it give a little call. Oh, wow, everyone. That is great. Fantastic, Dave. Well done. As it flew, I just heard it give the... Or half the call, half of the fish eagle call. I wonder if I can do the fish eagle call. Oh dear. African fish eagle. Something like that, I think. But it sounds much better when they do it, obviously. Yeah. Oh dear, it looks like the rain is coming. Oh, maybe we get to go to the tent. I haven't been to the tent yet. Who knows, if it starts raining harder, this isn't anything serious just yet. Anyway, what a wonderful sighting of the fish eagle. That is a really nice surprise. We do get a lot in this area, but mainly down, I'd say this area within the Sabi Sands, but mainly down around the permanent rivers, like the Sand River, which is south of here. There are a lot of fish eagles around there. I wonder what our list is actually in the last 2 weeks since I've been here, how many birds I've seen. It's been a great birding time, or time for birding rather. William, you trying to add to your bird list? Okay, let's... Well, as we're driving along, we'll see how many we can get for you. I hope you added that fish eagle. That was a nice one. See, the birds aren't as active this morning as they usually are because of this weather, cloudy, overcast. These brakes are killing me. I thought I heard an interesting bird. Where is it? What is that? Wasn't that a... It is indeed a black-backed puffback. And he's jumping around in these first few branches leaning towards us. Oh, there it goes. It just flew off, everyone. Little black-backed puffback. Unfortunately, it flew off quite quickly. Taylor would ask me if I can do the call of the black-backed puffback. Give me a second. Black-backed puffback. Okay, they've got an interesting call, and it sounds something like this. They go. Uh, think that's right. They do. Where's my app? Let me get my app out there. I'm doubting myself a little bit. They do. They... Hang on, everyone. Let me just get this for you quickly and make sure that I'm right. I don't think I'm wrong. Can you see there's a bit of drizzle starting now? So when we do head back to Taylor shortly, then we'll also get our rain covers on, I think. Let me just quickly find the puffback for you. Black-backed puffback. Oh dear, what do I do there? I'll show you a picture of it too. There. Do you hear that? Very close. That's a little bit more excited. Let me show you a pic. Kirsten says mine was like a slow-mo version. Thank you for that, Kirsten. There we go. It's a black-backed puffback. Beautiful bird. And it does indeed puff the feathers on the back up, hence the name the puffback. Look at that. But now the feathers are white that it puffs up. So it's the back is black, but the feathers, when it does puff them up, are white. It's a black-backed puffback. Try say that 5 times fast. All right, so we're going to head back to Taylor with the lions. While I do that, we're going to quickly set up our rain covers and that. So let's see what the lions are up to.
So then Kahumas are still fast asleep. They don't seem to be enjoying this miserable day that we're having. All the little cubs still cuddled up together. One is having a little drink. And those impala have sort of moved away, but there's still one lioness, that young lioness that's still watching in the distance. Now we'll probably have to put our rain covers on in the next couple of minutes as well, but we'll let Byron finish putting his on first, because we can't put ours on, obviously, right here with the lions. That'd be a good way to wake them up. And of course, well, they probably won't appreciate that. There we go. You can. Oh no, now they're both grooming themselves. They've lost interest in the impala. But there's still another herd coming. The one herd has crossed now and moved quite far away. But that big herd of impala that we saw just before we got here is still slowly bumbling along the side. Now I'm also going to do my black-back puffback call for you, but I don't know if I can do it here because I might disturb the lions. Now, speaking about all these lovely impala that we've been seeing, and we know that most of the females are pregnant, and they're looking quite rump. So they're... Not rump, plump, sorry. Change the words there. And they're probably going to give birth soon. Now, I know that Dayton, you were wondering if that makes the female impala less nimble. And I think to a degree it does. They've got those big bulging bellies. I don't think that they can leap as high as they can and run as fast. Well, they're still pretty good at running, but I think they won't be as quick as what they normally are. But they'd still be able to get away from the lions, even with that sort of course I'm doing this in inverted commas, that disadvantage to the females having the big bellies. They're still quicker than the lions if the lions haven't got that element of surprise. Hey, little one, your elbows are still a bit itchy, and you can see that's sort of the areas that are plagued by the mange. Is typically around the elbows. That's where it starts, and on their legs. But it looks like it's disappearing. What do you think, Brian? They don't look as dark and mangy as they have been. I haven't seen the lions now. It really does feel like it's been ages. You can see there underneath its paw as well, just cleaning the tail. But I think they're looking very good, and I think it has been all the food that they've been able to feast on. And their immune systems are very, very sort of high and healthy. And that will combat that mange, of course. So that's fantastic. And now what's going to happen is that if they do all survive and they all have clean coats again, That means that they're going to build up an immunity from this mange, which is quite exciting. And that's it. Those are the strongest genes that are supposed to survive. So it was very sad, of course, with the Styx cubs, but they just obviously weren't meant to carry on. And these N'Kahumas have just shown how powerful and how strong they really are. But you know who will be a good gauge is that if we find my little favorite girl to see how she's doing. Because she had it the worst, so she will think, I think she'll be the best judge. And if she's looking as great as the others, well, how fantastic will that be? I think I will probably jump for joy. All squeezing in to try and find the teat that has the most milk. Oh, and that's the little one too that has the nick out of its ear. Can you see it? It's also healing quite nicely. Because at one point it was spewing a little bit of blood. But it seems as though it's closing up. And I'm sure it'll have a little notch out of the side of its ear. But it, obviously nothing serious. It's, this one will definitely come out a survivor. Look how she's stretching her legs and stretching her toes. Did you see how she pushed the pads between her feet open? That was quite funny. You know what it's like when you wake up in the morning and you do a big stretch. You stretch your arms out. When you're laying in bed, you flex your feet as well. And it always feels so great. But she's had enough of that now. My little lions. Where's my friend? Well, that's a clever spot to go and lay under a couple of trees, because if it does start to drizzle, at least they'll have some shelter. But I think that the spitting that we're getting at the moment doesn't really matter. I don't even think we need to put our rain covers on. Those big drops have now subsided. Hello, Mom. Oh, you're very itchy still. Oh, look at the wound that she has on her leg. Can you see that? It almost looks like it's a bite mark. I don't know if you saw on that lioness's right sort of elbow. It looks like there's a hole of some sort. Now, obviously, like we've been saying, we don't know what always causes these injuries. We can only speculate. But that looks like quite a deep wound. It does look like a tooth mark. Now, Donald, you were wondering, where are all the males? Now, I'm not sure where the male lions are at. I know that they had some one set of tracks. It seems as though crossing east over Cheetah Cut Line, perhaps into Torchwood. We know we saw Mr. Mfumo with one of the Styx lionesses the other afternoon. So perhaps he's still with her, mating with her, around Chitwa side. Because I think Byron would have picked up on any lion tracks if he did see them on the boundary. He wouldn't have missed them if they were sitting on the road. Oh, now those drops are coming back again. I spoke too soon. So perhaps those lion tracks that were seen this morning, those male lion tracks going east into Torchwood, that was possibly, of course, Mr. Tenyor's footprints. And now, speaking of suckling, as we've been chatting and how these cubs are getting older and they're going to stop suckling fairly shortly, just the youngest ones, that their mom will still be producing a little bit of milk. Justin, you were wondering if I thought that humans could drink lion milk. I reckon they probably could. Whether it would taste nice or not, I'm not sure. I don't know if I would drink lion milk, though. And good luck to the person who'd ever want to try and milk a lion too. I think that would be very brave and probably quite silly to do. I don't think they would appreciate us doing that. So I'm not sure. I've never heard of anybody doing it. I don't think there's anybody brave enough to take on that challenge. See, these little ones are waking up. And I've seen my little floppy-eared girl. She's also decided to wake up now. She's still got her floppy ear. But she's even looking a lot better. You remember how she had so much mange on all over her ears? Now, there's still a bit on her left ear, but they're starting to look better. The right ear seems to be recovering quite nicely. The hair is starting to grow again. She's looking lovely. She's looking much better. So I told you, you've got to have a positive mindset. You've got to feed the animals positive vibes all the time. Otherwise, if you're negative about them, well, then I suppose then how can they be confident about their own appearance? I think she's looking lovely, and I think she's going to come out of this 100%. However, I reckon if this had to have happened in the summer months, so sort of in February, I think it would have been a different outcome. Now, speaking about this, Jenny, you're asking if I think the rain can help the mange, possibly, in cleaning them. But like I said, I think if this had happened, if these cubs had got the mange in, say, February, when we normally would have had quite a bit of rain and the grass would have grown and the animal sort of herds would have split up, I don't know if these cubs would have come and survived the mange as well as what they've done now. Maybe they could have, but I think they would have been sort of infected with it sort of way more. And the reason for that is because they wouldn't have been eating as much. The herds of animals disappear. It becomes more difficult because the bush is greener. So the lions don't blend into the vegetation as well as they do in the yellow season, the winter months, the dry season. And I think that they probably maybe would have lost a cub or two to it. But thank goodness that it happened now. And they obviously are building an immunity against it and fighting it off. And that's you can really only say thank you to the wonderful lionesses who are fantastic huntresses. Well, they all seem to be moving to get a bit of shelter, but it's not really proper rain. It's sort of just spitting. Like I said, the odd nimbostratus cloud is coming over us, spitting down, and then it clears, and then another small cloud comes. They've completely lost interest, though, now, in those impala. They've moved off. Both lionesses have moved back. Here comes the last one. Also going straight underneath all the different trees. And I just love the way that they're so excited to see each other all the time. And it just shows that that unity that they have between the different members is just incredible. Going in for a groom. See it. All that mange is clearing up now. The hair is starting to grow back. This is really, really wonderful. Practicing the jugular hold. Don't do that to Mom. That's not very nice. Now, of course, now these lionesses get less and less tolerant, of course. But she's still bigger and stronger than the cubs, so she can just sort of bowl them all over by licking them. Well, that's a bit cheeky, grabbing onto a very soft piece of skin and now tugging. And you can see that they do have a lot of loose skin on them at the moment. I'm talking about the adults, of course. And that's because they aren't as sort of fat as what they normally are, which is unusual. And of course, they've got to have all that extra skin so that when they do gorge themselves, they are able to sort of stretch their stomachs out as much as they can. No, little one, you've got to lick Mom, not the tree. Mom reaching the belly. Looks like she's picking out some ticks now. And she'll sort of comb through the hair with her little teeth in front between her canines. And then she'll pull all those ticks off. No, don't lick the tree, lick Mom. Obviously that cub is enjoying this. There we go. That's nice. Repay the favor. And of course you can see these cubs, they just can't help themselves. They lick, 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 and then they turn it into a killing strategy of trying to bite and pull at the skin, bite the ears, and those, I'm sure those little claws are coming out as well, hooking into Mom's face. Sounds like these elephants are getting closer. Still a bit far away, but they're definitely moving around in the drainage line below us. So possibly they're making their way here. And, well, they'll get a surprise, or then Kahumas will get a surprise, I suppose. And that little one must have lots of ticks on it. Not big ticks, though, they're just small ones. There we go. You can actually see how she pulled one out. There's a little black speck on its stomach, and I think that that was a tick. You see that? Oh, you can see all the ticks now on that little one's tummy. And that's what Mom is trying to get rid of. And sometimes, even though they've got all those hard bristles on their tongue, sometimes that's just not enough to remove the parasites. Like I said, so she uses those front teeth like a little comb and then bites them and pulls them out. Yeah, little one, you're not doing a good job at grooming. This is lovely. Now, Clay was asking this morning, how many lions is it that takes care of the various cubs? So Clay, it's all of them really. In this particular pride, three of the lionesses have had cubs. The youngest female didn't, and Amber Eyes hasn't had cubs yet either. But even though two of them haven't had cubs, you will often see them sort of taking care of these young cubs, whether it's by grooming them or just playing with them. So they all have a role in raising the cubs, even if it's not their own. But of course Mom will show preference to her own cubs, but she'll even allow some of the other cubs to come and suckle from her too. The little one's got distracted now and found a stick to chew on, and I'm sure that lioness is appreciating that. They're growing up so quickly. It's just incredible to see the sort of difference. And I think it would be quite nice if you put a little collage or something together of what those little Nkuhumas used to look like when they first came out to what they look like now. I think that would be quite nice. But I think, unfortunately, we're going to have to head out of the sighting. I think there's a couple more guides that want to come and see them, but it's been absolutely wonderful, as usual. But let's go back across to Byron and see how his chilly morning is going.
I'm doing fine, thank you, Taylor. I'm getting a little bit wet, not too bad just yet. Just a light drizzle. But the animals do seem to be hiding away from us a little bit. They're not enjoying this weather, or the change rather. We may still find something interesting, who knows. I actually wanted to find out, now that there was where was it? Maybe it was further down. There was a community nest spider web that we saw around here a few weeks ago, about almost 2 weeks ago. Found one that had a bird nest inside it. There were little bee eaters. Not bee eaters, I'm lying. Little sunbirds that were nesting inside this spider web. But I think it was further down the other side of this road. We'll definitely try to check it in a few days and see if those chicks are still inside. Because there were little chicks in there, which was interesting. It's amazing how the weather affects the animals' movements, and they do tend to go and look for shelter. There's some impala dotted around. Every now and then I get a glimpse, and if you have a look, there's actually some off to our right. Here we go.
It's very peaceful. If you listen carefully, you might be able to hear the raindrops on my cap and on the rain covers that we've got on. Oh, I can hear a wildebeest calling off in that direction, everyone. We can't see him. Probably about 100 meters away or so. They do that wonderful, like a strange snorting sound. It's usually an alarm call, or if males are fighting with one another or challenging each other for territory. Knee, 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 knee. I think that's pretty accurate. Is that not good? Oh dear, oh dear. Maybe it's too early for my animal calls. From Oregon, you asked if I could be any animal in Africa, what would I be? I think I'd be a honey badger, Cheryl. I love honey badgers. They're fascinating little creatures, and they're tough. They're not afraid of anything. They're tenacious. Fantastic little creatures, and I think I'd like to be a honey badger. It could be quite fun. That or maybe a big old elephant, a big elephant bull. That could also be quite cool. So one of those two, I would say, but preferably I think first choice would be a honey badger. I haven't seen any leopard tracks anywhere this morning while we've been driving. Been looking around, actually drove past that area just where we saw Tingana yesterday, that big male leopard. A magnificent cat, a beautiful, beautiful big tom. That's what we call a big male leopard, a tom. And obviously he moved off and I couldn't really see which direction he went, but it was so... you know what, everyone? There's a red-crested koran calling just behind me in that direction. Let's just see if we can maybe find it quickly. Let's have a look. They're the ones who do those beautiful aerial displays. So if we can find it, that would be great. Maybe we're lucky and it displays for us. Hang on a second. Let's have a look here quickly. All right. Now, I did this before, and I learned this from a track I used to work with, and he would sometimes sit and tap on the bonnet when we got close to these red-crested korons, and occasionally they'd react to it, because part of their call is it sounds like a tapping sound, in the beginning of their call, and then they do this wonderful whistle. And let's just listen out and hear if we can see it. But often what we would do is try and tap on the bonnet a little bit, and these birds would sometimes react to us and either do the aerial display or come and have a look and investigate. So let's see. If it's close enough, it might hear us. Let's hear. Can't see it, but it was in these bushes. It could have been a little bit further in. not interested in calling again. Let's just listen for another few seconds. No, doesn't look like it's interested in coming out for us now. And obviously it's going to keep quiet. Murphy's Law, isn't it? but they are beautiful birds, and they do this wonderful aerial display. They shoot up into the air, they take off, they fly up very, very, well, not that high, but quite a few meters up into the sky. And what they do is they stop flapping their wings, and they actually roll in the air, almost doing a backflip in the air, and they roll around, and then they come back and they parachute back down to the ground. It's an incredible aerial display. There it goes. Isn't that it there? Running across the... There we go. There it goes, the red-crested Koran. Yeah, okay. Let's see, everyone. Maybe it came to investigate. Let's see where it's going. I can still see it. Let's see if it will do a display for us. It's just off to the left. It's picking away at some seeds, perhaps, or insects. Okay, let's see. There it is. Okay, I'm going to tap again. Let's see if it reacts. There it is, Dave. Just running on the ground. There it goes. I'm going to go left more. There it goes. Just walking through there. There we go. Little red-crested Korhan. Isn't that beautiful? Look at that, everyone. But this one doesn't seem to be too interested in us. Well, at least we got to see it. So, you know, I wasn't making it up. It was here. And as that Korhan runs away, let's head back to Taylor, and she's got some more elephant to show you.
Not only do I have some elephants, and this is not going to be my main focus, this is a... I've got the black cuckoo shrike. It's calling here and I saw it. And I don't know if any of you have ever seen a black cuckoo shrike before. I haven't seen one in years, so I'm quite keen to try and find it. So let's look for it. Just flew over us and we're going to sit. It's behind us and I need to turn around. Sorry, elephants, they were disappearing into the... It's up. I think it's up here somewhere. Oh, there it is. You see on the tree in the distance, it's just flying. Behind this one at the back, down there. Okay, it's flying. There it goes. You see it? Down there. Let's go find it. We're chasing after a black cuckoo shrike. No, it flew across. There it is. It's landed up there. Okay, I've got it. Yes, that was it. If you saw that little black thing. I'm going to stop far away. Can you see it up there, Brian? There it is, black cuckoo shrike, red mouth, yellow wings, yellow spots on the wing. Now this is the male. The female's quite pretty. I'll show you a photo of her. I want to actually try and go a little bit closer. Let's try and sneak closer. I hope it's not going to fly away. Don't fly away. I'm going to just try and keep on it. They're quite shy birds, but that's incredible. I'm so glad that we've seen a black cuckoo shrike. Now let us know, have any of you ever seen this? I'm sure this is going to be a new bird for some of you. Still sitting there. Don't fly, little birdie, don't fly. We want to try and get a good view. Here we go, a little bit closer now. I'm sure you can hear it calling. turning the game drive radio off. This is fantastic. He's obviously calling looking for a female. The females are quite pretty as well. They're a little bit more green and yellow. But of course, I think I showed you a photo yesterday morning, and they've got the black barring with the yellow and a bit of green tinge sort of on their bodies too. Where have you gone? You're just jumping. Now we should see the wing spot. You see that yellow little spot there? That's fantastic. I was wondering at one point if I was going a bit crazy because I'd never seen them in the area. And off it goes. Yay! I'm so happy finally after I heard it. Like I said, that is a bird that I'm really sort of know quite well. And I said to you, it brings back fond memories of the Eastern Cape. You used to see them everywhere, almost as common as a fork-tailed drongo. So that's really lovely to see. Like I said, now we've seen the male. We need to try and find a female, and they're really, really beautiful. So that'll be my next challenge. But these ellies have come out now. Let's see if we can get a better view of them. That was perfect. Right, we're going to have a look. I'm just going to position myself. James has asked a fantastic question this morning with regards to the name of the cuckoo shrike and how does it get it. I'm going to actually have to get out my app on my phone and have a little look, so we shall do that. I don't need to play the call again. I'm not sure, but we will read very quickly while we look at that beautiful elephant. I'm just going to have a look. So it does tell you a little bit about, of course, their names. Hello, Ellies. Now, let's see down here. Oh, nothing yet. They're not. I'm just trying to go back, actually. You know what I might have to do is I've got a really good book back in my room that explains where they get their names from. And I might have to read that and tell you, because I'm not sure. I don't think they're related to cuckoos. I don't know if they parasitize or are parasitized by any birds. Let me just double check. Hello, beautiful. Well, they're all walking past us. Isn't this amazing? And we did hear some elephants screaming and shouting, but I don't think that it's them because they seem to be very relaxed by us. Okay, so James, what I'm going to do is I'm going to get back to your question this afternoon. I'm going to do a bit of research and see what I can dig up about the names of this thing. I keep hearing a shouting noise, but I don't know what it is. That didn't sound very elephant-like. Maybe.
Maybe.
It sounded very much like a dinosaur. It feels as though we're in Jurassic Park this morning. But I think it's quite a big herd of elephants moving through here and around us. So maybe it's a youngster throwing a tantrum. Yes, it's very much Jurassic Park-like. What's going on? Let's go and investigate what's happening. I don't know what's going on there. It just seems like it's one elephant that's slightly riled up about something. But cheers, chaps. Young boys that passed the vehicle, they're moving off. There's a little calf running away. Oops, sorry. You can see that little one's got its tail raised away from its body. Its ears slightly also sort of flared out. So perhaps this is the one that's making all the noise. It's running. Maybe it got left behind. I'm not sure why it's making such a racket. Yes, it's that one making all the noise. Let me go forward so we can see if we can get a view of it. They're making all these strange noises. What's wrong, little Ellie? It's not little. When I say little, it's probably older than 8 years, maybe even 10 years old. There it is. Can just see it, just a tiny little glimpse of it in the distance behind all the bushes. You can see it. Settle down, little one. Well, it must be relaxing now, the fact that it started eating. And there's another little one racing over towards it, just coming from the other side, maybe going to comfort it, I don't know. I wonder why that little one was so upset. It's okay. Maybe it will settle down now that it's found the bulk of the herd. There's actually quite a few elephants in there. Now that sounds like a younger elephant throwing a tantrum because mom won't let it suckle. You can see them moving further and further into the drainage line now, perhaps to get out of the wind. It's amazing, we always see such different things when we come out on drive and hear different things too. Now, hello, his Stygnus. I'm wondering, I haven't heard your name before. Perhaps you're a new viewer. If you are, welcome. Now, you're wondering if elephants are a nuisance to the locals. Now, they can indeed be. Sorry, my eye is watering slightly this morning for my wonderful hay fever that I have. Brian and I are both suffering from hay fever, sneezing and doing all sorts of things this morning. Now, in this area, it's not so bad. We've got, obviously, these massive fences around 8.5 million acres of land. So that tends to keep the elephants out of the community lands and, well, we try to keep the humans out of the elephants' land, that type of thing. So places like Zambia, and I can just talk about Zambia because I work there, they were a huge problem. And the reason being is because there was no fence at all. So you have the national parks, and then you have these game management areas just on the outside of the national parks where you've got more lodges and the animals can move around in. Then, outside of that, after those game management areas, you get the big villages that are growing maize and all types of different crops. And of course, during the drier seasons, when there's nothing left to eat, the elephants all move towards them and they destroy crops. And of course, it's a bit of a pest. Sorry, I'm gonna sneeze again. Am I gonna sneeze? No, it's gone. I made it disappear. Sorry about that. So yes, they can indeed be big pests. But they're trying different things to try and combat the problem. It seems like all the elephants have disappeared now. Well, they're pushing something down in the distance. And there were different techniques. I know while I was up there, they were trying to grow chilies in the area, and they said that that would deter the elephants. And it worked to a certain extent. And eventually the elephants just learnt and ploughed through that. The only effective way and thing that they can do is that they've put a proper electrified game fence up around their crops to try and keep the elephants out. And so I know quite a few of the owners of the various lodges were trying to assist the locals in doing that. And the reason why it was quite good to do that is because, unfortunately, the locals would retaliate and try and chase elephants with spears and things like that. And then, of course, the elephant would just get hurt in the process. We don't want that at all. So people are trying to try and find ways that we can come to terms to try and look after the locals trying to produce produce, which, of course, they have a right to get upset because that's how a lot of them are making their money, is by growing various crops and then, of course, selling them and, well, also to feed themselves. Again, I've got another stick under the vehicle. That's stick number 665 for today. Get out. You're not welcome. Just Brian and the thumb and myself that are allowed in the vehicle. Seems as though I managed to get rid of it. Sometimes you get lucky and you're able to do the reversing trick and then out goes the stick. Sometimes not. You have to crawl underneath the vehicle in order to remove it. Right. So I haven't really got a plan now. We're just going to carry on and see what we bump into along the way. Now, of course, I got severely distracted by that cuckoo shrike. Oh, my goodness. It's another stick. Lots of sticks. Now, James, you were saying when we clean the vehicles, what type of wildlife do we find in them? You want to know if we find any snakes. Now, thankfully, no snakes just yet. But I must tell you a very funny story about, and I'll get back to your question, but you've just reminded me of something. So the other evening, I've been telling you, you know how hot it's been here the last couple of nights, and it's been so humid. So we went off to Inga's where Brent and Jamie stay, and we all had a swim, which was just before we went to bed, just to cool ourselves down, and it was lovely.
We're all joking around, and the next minute Byron shouts, "Snake! Snake!" Everybody starts panicking, looking, getting these torches to try and see where the snake is. And of course, Brian and I were just sitting on the side having a good chuckle because we weren't swimming. We were just, we had our feet in the pool though, and having good laughs, thinking that it's going to be this monster snake that's coming towards them. I kid you not, it was a snake about that big. It was the tiniest little snake you've ever seen in your entire life, not even the length of a ruler, not even probably half the length of a ruler, and they were all squealing like little girls, these big strong men. And we had a good chuckle about that. Eventually we got the pool scoop and we scooped it out and we set it free. I still actually haven't worked out what snake it was just yet. We have a video, but we haven't got around to identifying it just yet. But that was quite funny. So James, to get back to your question, most of the things that we find are actually insects. So from dung beetles that have spent the night in the vehicle, to dry the ants, to a variety of moth species. Remember that one day I had a collection of moths on the dashboard, so that they sometimes hang around. A couple of praying mantises I've seen, and well, yeah, all sorts of little beetles and things. And lots of mosquitoes. Mosquitoes absolutely love to live in here, so you open the door and you see them fly out, and then you carry on, of course. So that's always quite fun, and you learn about all the various insects. We're going to carry on and we're going to try and search for something. Perhaps we come across that female cuckoo shrike, but whatever we're going to do next, you'll be able to find out in a little bit. Let's go back across to Byron and see how he's doing.
That is wonderful that Taylor got to find that black cuckoo shrike. That is a bird that you don't often see. So well done, Taylor. That is really, really a nice tick for our birders out there. And I hope she is able to find the female, because it is really beautiful and completely different to the male. So that is wonderful. A nice surprise for the morning. Black cuckoo shrike. That's very cool. We haven't had too much luck, everyone. Just a few impala darting off into the thickets. Staying quite close together again because of the wind and this weather that we're having. But not too much else. Haven't seen any tracks, haven't heard any alarm calls. Haven't found any elephant. Taylor seems to be having all the luck with the elephant and the lions this morning. I know she was telling you the story about the snake in the pool. I think I saved everyone's life by finding it. No, it was a tiny little one, but we were just sitting and the next thing this little snake came swimming past. And because it was still quite dark, I could hardly see, and I was having a good look, and there's a snake in the pool. Has no one got a torch? And eventually we saw what it was and we got it out and identified it. Nothing too venomous, so we weren't in any danger. But it just shows you do have to be careful out here. We've got to, when we are around, we constantly check for scorpions and snakes. And one of the rules I always tell my guests, or hints rather, is that if you are in the bush and you're in the camps and wherever, in the mornings when you wake up and you're putting your shoes on, just always tap your shoes, and just to make sure there's nothing that crawled in, because you can get little scorpions and that climbing in at times. So it doesn't matter where you are, just always have a good look. So Jody, you asked, I just missed the beginning, what are out yet? Chameleons. The chameleons are out. We've seen two now in the last week, Jody. We saw one last night. Brian had an amazing spot. He was with me on drive, and he spotted one in a tree, an incredible spot. Nice big flap-necked chameleon sitting in a tree. So we've seen two. James saw one the other night, and then we saw one last night. So slowly but surely, starting to see more and more of them getting active. I do think we need a bit more rain though, because obviously the chameleons feed on the insects, and the more insects around, the more chameleons we'll start seeing. So I think when there's a bit more moisture and a bit more rain, we'll probably start seeing more of these reptiles coming out. Snakes, chameleons. Janine, you asked actually, do we come across snakes very often? Not that often, Janine. We do see snakes out here, but we don't actually come across them that often. Now and then, if you're lucky, while you're driving, you'll get one that'll slither across the road, or you might see snake tracks, but mainly in summer. I think we've still got some time before we start seeing a lot of snake activity, but not that often. Snakes do try and avoid people, and I mean, they pick up on the vibrations of the vehicle and that before we even get close to them. Dory, I do check my shoes every morning. I always tap my shoes when I wake up before I put them on, just to make sure nothing's crawled in, because last thing you want is to be stung on the toe by a scorpion before you go out and game drive. So I do check my shoes. A new viewer, welcome. your Twitter handle is one stoner, two cats. Well, welcome. It's nice to have you with us. You wanted to know, how do we keep critters from wandering in through the camp at night? So obviously insects and snakes and anything like that, they all come into camp. You know, there's nothing you can do against that. But the other animals like hyena and that, we do have a gate that we close, so that generally keeps animals out out of the camp. But you never know, you could still have something wandering around. I woke up this morning quite early, and there was something walking outside my window. I could just hear it, but to be honest, I was quite comfortable in bed, so I didn't actually have a look. But the night before, there was an elephant right outside our windows, and it was breaking some branches and making an awful noise at about 1 o'clock in the morning while we were trying to sleep. The rain is getting a bit harder now. I'm sure you can all hear that. Going to have to swim home. All the way from Oregon. Clay, you wanted to know, how far do we actually drive on a game drive like this? Do we stay close to the base, or do we end up driving quite far? So Clay, obviously it's a little bit tricky with us because we need the signal, and it's still fascinating that we're able to take you on a live safari and drive around, and that you can still watch from home. But obviously signal is a big thing for us. We are able to traverse over the whole of Vuyatela, all this Juma game reserve, which is nice. And then to be honest, from here all the way to, or from camp to Cheetah Plains, it's probably a good, I think the furthest we get is maybe 15 kilometers away or so. 15, 20 kilometers, which is about, what's that, 12 or 14 miles, somewhere around there, I would guess. So it's quite a distance that we do drive away from the lodge. I hope my conversions are right there, but I think so. Hey, maybe, yeah, ish, I don't know. Right, I'm just actually going to head down this road here. I've got a feeling we're going to find something exciting. Who knows? Right, while we head down here and look for something exciting, let's head back to Taylor with all her rain covers on.
All our rain covers are on, including my rain cover, of course, as you can see, my lovely black one. Keep me nice and dry. Oh, we've got a kudu that's looking a little bit on the damp side. Here she is. Hello, girl. Oh, a whole family of damp kudu. Try and sneak up to them. Hey, guys. No, don't run away. Well, you can see that lovely flash of white that they have underneath their tail. And a young male, of course. You can see they're just getting a little bit wet. Oh, the one at the back looks quite wet. Or is that, what is that? Is that mange or is that just water? No, just water. An interesting color, this one. You know, it doesn't look like it's got the greatest skin condition, unfortunately. Looks, seems to be a little bit on the dark side. Maybe a little bit itchy, but that's what happens, of course, as we've been chatting about, is when the immune systems of the various animals are lowered and well, for particularly the herbivores, it's quite tough. I don't know what that was. It was quite unusual. Lovely family just munching away though. I've already seen the impalas starting to sit down. There's a common dacre. Sorry, I've just spotted a little common dacre moving through the thicket. Off it goes. And I think that these guys are probably going to move into the thicker vegetation. Now the drops are getting a little bit harder than what they normally, or what they have been this morning. And you'll find that the kudu may even go and have a sit down too, and perhaps ruminate. Hello, little one. He's beautiful. He's obviously very young though. He's probably almost only about 2 years old. You've still got a long way to go, and of course, that oxpecker is having a meal and I'm sure is keeping nice and warm huddled up against that. Oh, that little kudu. You see how it sort of did a bit of a leap and it caught something? Maybe it was a tick trying to make an escape. You will not escape ticks. That oxpecker is on you. Oh, something gave them a fright. I don't know if you saw a couple of them sort of darted and jumped away. And that, of course, is a natural reaction if they think that something is there as they're moving around in the bushes. Especially when you're young, you will leap away from that area. And it's beautiful boy looking back at us. Bye-bye, oxpecker. Even the oxpecker said, right, that's enough rain for me, I'm out. Now we're seeing all sorts of strange patterns on these beautiful kudu. Now, sinful butterfly, you were wondering if those were scratches. I'm wondering, I don't think you're talking about the white stripes that they have, but you can see running horizontally across those stripes, it looks like there's a bit of a scratch. Possibly. Their skin isn't as tough as the skin of a rhino or a buffalo or even an elephant. And often when they walk through the thicker vegetation, when the thorns sort of run through their coat, and now that they're a bit damp too, it leaves a funny pattern on their hair. But in just in case you are maybe talking about those white stripes, those are called disruptive markings. And you'll see that different animals have got different ways to try and camouflage themselves, to try and hide themselves away. And it's a very nice combination that a kudu has. A kudu has got a darker grey neck compared to the rest of their body. And then it sort of turns to be a light brown with those white stripes on them. And that helps break up the solid shape of those kudu. And they're able to blend into the vegetation. Like you can see, there's a kudu standing at the back, just behind the two that we're looking at. And look how well camouflaged it is. You can just sort of see it when it starts to move. But you can see clearly how those white stripes make it blend into the trees and the leaves a little bit better. I think they are just a bit damp. But that one's got much darker colouring on it. It almost looks like it's a male, like the colouring of a male kudu. Quite interesting. Isn't this lovely? But I think let's continue from here. Let's see what else this road has got for us. I saw a bird in the distance. And go and see which bird it was. I couldn't quite identify it from over here. Now, I must remind you, if you do see a little cloth coming across your screen, it's just Brian cleaning and making sure that the raindrops aren't disturbing your view. Oh my goodness, well, I'm not going to be able to find out what bird that is because I have a roadblock that I need to move off of the road. So while I do this, let's go back across to Byron, who has got an elephant.
Just as I thought, everyone. Remember I said we're going to find something exciting, and we found a young male elephant. I'm very happy because you all know how much I enjoy elephant and love spending time with them. And you can hear the rain is getting a bit harder again. This light drizzle. A drizzle, bit of rain, but it's, it looks like it's here to stay for a while, judging by the clouds around us. And if we just look behind this elephant and look at that cloud cover. Another ominous morning in the African bush. Patsy Poop, you wanted to know if the elephant dung makes for good fertilizer. And it does. I think if you the one thing about elephant dung, though, is that it isn't broken down very well. So, to be honest, it probably wouldn't be the best fertilizer. I think if you got some other dung from antelope species in that, and maybe buffalo, that would probably make better fertilizer. But the elephant dung is very coarse, because all the plant material that they feed on, a lot of it moves straight through their body. You know, they only absorb about 30% of the food that they feed on and the nutrients. So elephant dung is very coarse and made up of a lot of grass and plant material. So it would probably make some good fertilizer if you add it to a garden, but I would probably go for antelope dung or buffalo dung that's broken up even further. That would probably make better fertilizer. Really enjoying that bush. That little tree that he's feeding on. I'm hoping he decides to come a little bit closer. Wouldn't that be nice? I do love it when these elephants walk up to the vehicle and close to us. Yeah, this rain is starting to come down a little bit harder now. Wonderful. Ah, can you hear another elephant in the distance, everyone? I just heard another low grumble, but it was probably about 60 or 70 meters away from us, just behind this elephant. You can't see it. I've looked around, can't see it at all. But there's definitely another elephant or two hiding in there, maybe another male. Often these young males do
end up spending time together and forming these small groups. Look how he's feeding them a branch in the face and trying to pull the leaves off. And well, it's been a wonderful morning. I hope you've all enjoyed it. Sacco, you wanted to know if animals become more active when it's raining or less active, and it's hard to say. I do think that in weather like this, it probably doesn't affect them too much. They'll still move around and continue with whatever it is they need to do, drink, feed, and that's basically it. But if it rains heavily, then they'll definitely go and look for a bit of shelter and try and move out of the heavy rain. But some animals will still stand out. I mean, we need to remember that these animals have adapted to the climatic conditions which we receive around here. Look at those nails on the elephant. But I think in general, the weather definitely affects the animals in some way. And we've seen it a bit this morning. We've been driving around. We haven't seen too much. It's been a little bit quieter for us. Taylor's been lucky. She's seen some elephant and the lions. They managed to find the lions. So that's great, but it does change. And I've seen predators moving around in rain like this. The other thing that does happen is sometimes the predators enjoy hunting in weather like this because the rain will mask their sound and their smell if they're stalking prey. So a lot of animals or predators do enjoy hunting in weather like this, especially if it rains a little bit harder. Often we would find leopard in that moving around and hunting and then probably finding them with a kill after a nice big storm because they were able to hunt in the rain. So I think we're going to leave this beautiful elephant. Lovely to see a nice male, and he's going to enjoy his breakfast. I think what we're going to do is we're going to head back and try to find breakfast for ourselves. Thank you, everyone, for a great morning. Hope you've enjoyed it with us. Thank you to Dave on camera. And from myself, a goodbye. We'll see you this afternoon. We're going to head back to Taylor, and she'll end off the show and maybe tell you something a little interesting for the last few minutes. Goodbye, everyone.
Byron, you must have a telepathic connection. You won't believe what I just saw. It was so quick. As I got to the tree that I wanted to move off of the road, I heard these birds alarm calling like crazy. They're all shouting from the starlings to, I don't even know what was in there, the prineas. They were all shouting at something. So I stopped and I stared and I stared and I thought that maybe it was a snake, and out burst a serval. I got a quick glimpse of it and then it carried on running. I think because there's also a herd of elephants around here, and that it was obviously quite startled and it just kept running into the bushes, and unfortunately we couldn't get a shot of it. It happened so quickly, but it was so nice because that was the first serval that I'd seen since I'd been here, and it was quite amazing. I was just sad that we didn't get to have a look at it, but we tried. We kept looking around, but now that we know that there's one hanging around in the area, it might be worth sort of coming around and carry on checking these areas. They're quite territorial. So that was very exciting. It was just a quick glimpse. I couldn't even tell you if it was a male or a female, a big one or a small one. I just saw the beautiful markings of this sort of spotted striped cat. It was absolutely stunning. And of course, that bright yellow coloration on them really stood out in of course, the bush. Now, I believe I owe you a bird call. I owe you the call of a blackback puffback. And I couldn't do that call, unfortunately, in the lions because, well, I think it would have disturbed them a bit too much, especially those little cubs. So here it goes. Whew. Right. Are you ready? Now, you're probably going to have to vote and let us know who did the better blackback puffback call. But it seems as though, speaking of birds, all the birds are settling in now and are sitting under the shrubs because this rain is getting a little bit heavier. We're coming down to the final minute of the show. We're just taking a little bumble just to see perhaps if we never know what we could bump into around here. But it's been such a wonderful morning. Even though it's been a bit colder than normal, I definitely enjoyed it. And my highlight, and I'm sure you guessed it, was not seeing the Nkuhumas today, as much as I love them, but it was finally finding that black cuckoo shrike. So, woohoo, to me, I'm so happy. Now I can add another different bird to my list up here in the Lowveld. I hadn't had that. Now, thank you very much to Kirsty and Lou in Final Control. And I hope James had a good morning, resting, sleeping. Hopefully he's still sleeping sound. But we'll catch you again this afternoon for the Sunset Safari. From myself, Brian and the Thumb, it's been a pleasure.